Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
Good morning. Hey, I'm just wondering, how far back in our black history do you go? Do you go back to the period of when we were persecuted and pushed out of Israel, when we were as the Jews as we are now today? Do you teach your students that the blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans in America here now today are the original Jews of the Holy Bible? And did you even know that, number one? And, you know, as far as this oppression and all of that that we're going through, those are just curses from the Lord. The Lord is cursing us for turning against him.
We'll get a response. Professor Horne.
Well, I'm glad that that question was asked, because it provides me the opportunity to mention a book I published last year on the founding of the United States in 1776, where I argue that the founding was based in no small part on the desire by the settlers to evade abolitionism in London. The African population in the 18th century was largely opposed to slavery, and therefore that set up a dynamic where the black population was oftentimes viewed as an enemy of the state, which continued during the Jim Crow regime and arguably continues today and helps to shed light on this enormous rise in police killings that has taken place in Baltimore, in North Charleston, in Cleveland, in Ferguson, in Staten Island, and elsewhere. And I dare say, until that particular nettle is grasped, we're going to have difficulty in understanding what's going on with regard to the black population in the United States of America.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's day, Tuesday, June 30, 2020. So I have been told. Whew, what a summer it has been. Lots to report on. We'll try to cover as much as we can with the time we have allowed. Our book club, we will be back Thursday, July 2nd, Einstein on race and racism. Third segment. Excited, especially excited, because this book is not very long, and we might read Romaine Gary's White Dog afterward. But Einstein on race and racism first. Our broadcast for today, we've been on the air for 11 years. It's a little bit sad that it took us this long to have him on the broadcast, but wowee, we picked great timing with everything that is happening on the planet. We are really honored to have him on today to get some of his views. He is the Moores Professorship, holds the Moores Professorship of History and African American Studies at the University of Houston down in Texas, where the virus is surging, so they say. We'll discuss that as well. He is a prolific author, and that is kind of an understatement with the number of different books that he has written. I was checking out, with the context of everything that's going on, Fire This Time, the Watts Uprising in the 1960s. In fact, he was discussing that very book in the clip that we heard in the introduction for today's broadcast. Speaking of the Cows Book Club, not that long ago, we read his biography, Paul Robeson, Artist as Revolutionary. Lots of amazing information. Anybody, if you're not well-versed on the life and times of Paul Robeson, check out that bio. Great details. Many, many other books that take up a whole program just to give off his list of many great books, which all deal with the system of white supremacy. As I said, real privilege to have him on the program. Joining us live, author and professor, Dr. Gerald Horne. Dr. Horne, are you with us, sir?
Yes, I hope so.
Crystal clear. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Tuesday evening for our listeners. I know many of them are very familiar and huge fans of your work, but for folks who are being initiated, any brief thoughts you'd like to give on the work you do down at the University of Houston?
Well, first of all, thank you for inviting me. Second of all, if you're going to read White Dog, you should see the movie, too, with Paul Winfield. rather intriguing. Thirdly, I'm speaking to you from Houston, and to say that the virus is surging is an understatement. I think I have a glimpse now of what it means to live in a leper colony, in fact. And it's obviously the product of backward and retrograde politics, but that's the way it is right now. Now, with regard to my work, I assume we're going to talk about my book on the 16th century, but if not, that's okay. I just finished a manuscript on boxing, and it's being copy edited now, so that's fresh in my mind. So I'd be happy to talk about that. And then I have a couple books that are basically in suspended animation, because I need to visit archives, and archives are closed indefinitely. So I don't know when these will be finished. One is on Texas, the other is on Washington, D.C.
Wow. Anyone who is not familiar with Dr. Horne, if you look online and just see his really lengthy list of texts, like, wow, it would be hard pressed. So I'll tell you, my plan for the program, it was mandatory. We had to do a little bit of time on the bio on Paul Robeson, which came out 2016, just because we read that in the book club, and I thought that was relevant to what was happening now. The fire this time, the Watts Uprising, I thought that was somewhat relevant to what was happening, at least to put context into what was happening right now. And then it would be great to hear a little bit about the boxing manuscript as well. Does that seem feasible? And then we can get questions from listeners. Does that seem feasible, Dr. Horne?
It's all good.
Spectacular. If I could get a quick word just with the virus situation down in Texas, I think initially it was New York and some of the other locations, New Orleans, they were looked at as so-called hotspots. Now Texas is surging. Are they looking at doing shutting things down again, or do you know what the plan is for your state with Governor Abbott?
Well, as the county executive, Lena Hidalgo, said the other day, the plan seems to be hope. And I don't know if hope is going to be sufficient. Because I don't know if the virus understands that word. The virus doesn't respect borders. It doesn't respect your alleged good intentions. And the hospitals, quite seriously, are on the verge of being overrun. And Texas Medical Center is one of the largest hospital centers on planet Earth, and it's about to be overrun, to give you an idea of the seriousness of the problem down here. So just wish us luck. That's all I can say.
Wow. Dr. Horne started that response with hope and ended with luck. Like, man, that is gallows humor for 2020. What is your coronavirus response? Hope and luck. That is the Lone Star State of Texas. Wow.
I'm afraid so.
Do you have I know you're not a medical doctor or anything, but just do you have any thoughts? Because I know they've talked about Houston specifically and some of the areas where black people are being impacted. Specifically, any thoughts on how this is impacting black people?
Oh, it's devastating. It's terrible. And I think, at least in the beginning, that helps to explain the lethargy with which the authorities were addressing this pandemic. Because the news headlines kept telling us that the essential workers, who were heavily black people, were being devastated, and I don't think that that was sufficient to energize the authorities. But now, as it's apparent, it's spread beyond the black community, and once this virus begins to spread, it's difficult to restrain it because, as you know, the therapies for it, that is to say the curatives, or rather primitive, and then there's no vaccine as of yet, and it's unclear when there will be a vaccine. So this is a very seriously profound situation.
Life-changing. I've heard the word unprecedented more this year than I have in some time. We'll pivot from the virus and try to discuss some of your work, which all will seem to go back to white supremacy racism. It seems all topics do. For folks who've not seen you, you are a black male, yes?
That's what I've been told.
The response, accurate. This program, Context of White Supremacy, I use the term racism and the term white supremacy. I use them as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. That definition, a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a definition is accurate? Do you think such a system exists?
Well, of course it exists, but let me add a footnote. You know, I wrote this book on the 17th century, and the 17th century is when this project that eventuated in the United States basically began with the English invasion of what they call Virginia in 1607. A few days ago, my book on the 16th century just dropped. And actually, the book covers a period from about 1453 when the Ottoman Turks and the Muslims seized Constantinople, today's Istanbul, from the Christians. And then that brings fear into the hearts of many Western Europeans, which helps to induce the Spanish to sponsor Christopher Columbus across the Atlantic, which, of course, leads to our presence in North America. But just briefly, the question is, how did England wind up ruling North America when Spanish had the first mover's advantage? And to make a long story short, there was contestation between the English and Spanish on the basis of religion, Protestant London versus Catholic Madrid. The Protestants were the scrappy underdogs. They were outnumbered, and therefore they had to be more creative and improvisational. And so rather than rely upon a religious test, that is to say you have to be Protestant to be in the charmed circle, they basically wrong-footed the Spanish by moving towards pan-Europeanism, which morphs into whiteness, which morphs into white supremacy, which helps to explain the rise of England and then its revolting spawn known as the United States of America, and it helps to explain as well the point you introduced, this question of white supremacy, of which they were major executioners of.
Give us the full title of your new book again, Dr. Horne, please.
The Dawning of the Apocalypse, The Roots of Slavery, White Supremacy, Settler Colonialism, and Capitalism in the Long 16th Century.
Writing that.
This came out a few days ago.
Wow, in the midst of all this, that is impressive. Wow, okay. Putting that one down for the book club as well. I told Dr. Horne's ever-expanding library. Hugely impressive. I guess if you can, I was looking, really, to be truthful, I was looking at Fire This Time, the Watts Uprising, and the 1960s current author, but really, either book would kind of help put these current protests in context. You've been looking at kind of the same thing that we all have for the past month or so, even internationally now, with folks around the world joining in talking about George Floyd. Can you kind of talk to, and even touching back on the point that you raised in the segment we started with, saying that, hey, black people are viewed as enemies of the state all the way back to slavery, and that just continues today with what you see with George Floyd, Breonna Taylor.
Well, yes, and I think then the question becomes, well, then how did we escape those terrible situations if we were viewed so negatively? And I think the short answer is international assistance. The Haitian Revolution, 1791 to 1804, ignites the general crisis of the entire slave system in the Americas, including the United States, which could only be resolved with its collapse, which helps to ignite a U.S. Civil War, which leads to the formal abolition of slavery. And then if you fast forward to the era of U.S. apartheid, so-called Jim Crow, you have similar international pressures. That is to say, the United States is in a Cold War with the former Soviet Union. There is a fear that Moscow is feeling a march on Washington by basically offering scholarships and arms to Africans to fight their European colonizers and oppressors. And Washington feels that it will be difficult to win hearts and minds in Africa as long as peoples of African descent are treated so atrociously. So that creates a dynamic that leads to the retreat of Jim Crow. However, as I tell the story to bring it up to the present, basically in 1980, with the election of Ronald Reagan, you have the onset of a counter-revolution that arguably extends to May 25th, 2020, with the slaying, or the lynching, I should say, of George Floyd on camera. That helped to ignite domestic protests in the Atlantic to the Pacific, and most importantly, global protests, punctuated just a few days ago when Burkina Faso, the state in Central West Africa, on behalf of the African Union, headquartered in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, filed a motion at the Human Rights Council of the United Nations in Geneva, Switzerland, calling for a commission of inquiry into, quote, systemic racism, unquote, in the United States of America. Now, unfortunately, not least because I'm not sure how many of our folk on this side of the Atlantic, not to mention our organizations, were aware of this profoundly important initiative, it did not go forward, but it helps to signal this global spotlight in which the United States finds itself. Now, that's the good news. The bad news may be, is that there's this very strong counter-revolutionary impulse embedded in this society. And there's a distinct possibility that this counter-revolutionary impulse will begin to assert itself sooner rather than later. So I guess the signal to the folks in the street is to make hay while the sun shines, because we really need to take advantage of these forces aligning in our favor.
Do you think there'll be enough international attention? And I mean, there have been protests all over. We've had people on the program from across the globe, and they've been protesting in Brazil, France, the continent, Asia, all Japan. We had some of the folks who were over at some of the protests in Japan. Do you think that'll be enough? Because they protested in 2014 with Ferguson, Michael Brown. You had protests around the world then as well. And here we are, George Floyd, 2020. Do you think it'll be enough to really produce systemic change?
Too soon to say. I mean, one of the problems we have in this country is that the movement's very decentralized. That is to say, at one point, we were talking about my book by this time, The Watts Uprising in the 1960s, and one of the theses of that book deals with the rise of the Black Panther Party, which in Los Angeles, at least, sort of emerges from the Community Alert Patrol, which fundamentally involves these young brothers and sisters who have law books and cameras and are monitoring the police. And what's happening then, of course, helps to put the global spotlight as well on the United States. But the problem is that the Black Panthers, they were a centralized organization. That meant that they had leaders, spokespersons, chapters, newspapers, dues payers, missions in Algeria and elsewhere. But then when the nail sticks up, the hammer comes down. And so that means that the leaders were jailed, exiled, assassinated. Fred Hampton, Mark Clark, December 4th, 1969 in Chicago, for example. And so now as a creative adaptation, we have this decentralized movement, Black Lives Matter, sort of a leaderless protest. It's difficult to say who is spearheading, at least on the national level, these movements and who is in touch with our friends and comrades abroad. And that's a good thing insofar as it becomes difficult for the state to decide who they're going to hammer. But it's not so good because the movement relies a lot on spontaneity. It becomes difficult to plan. It opens itself up to hustles. You might have heard about this guy in Santa Clarita, California, who's raised millions under the banner of the Black Lives Matter movement, although it's unclear where this money is going. And so it's a very complex situation we face right now, and so it's difficult for me to predict or project how this situation is going to resolve itself.
Have that conclusion about many things with regards to 2020. One of the great quotes from your book, Fire This Time, The Watts Uprising in the 1960s, this is on page 39, and I just wonder if you see any of these same overtones to what's being reported right now with the protests, particularly the protests here in the U.S. and kind of some of what you've heard from the president. You write, studies by social scientists of what they called the riot were a minor cottage industry. However, the soundness of some perspectives could be questioned. Vernon Mark, who utilized sources from apartheid South Africa, entitled his contribution, Does Brain Disease Play a Role in Riots and Urban Violence? the idea that African Americans might be crazy was not an unusual thing, and this inevitably led to suggestions as to how their brains should be fixed. I'll stop there. Any overtones to what we're seeing right now in 2020?
Well, not necessarily. Let me see what that reminds me of. It reminds me of slavery, because, you know, I've written a lot of books on slavery. In the 19th century in the United States, there was this psychological syndrome known as streptomania, which was a syndrome that allegedly afflicted Africans, which caused them to want to flee the plantation, which meant that they were crazy. And then it reminds me of what I was involved in decades ago, when I was actually working with the Black Panthers in California, and I used to teach classes at this Vacaville State Prison in Northern California, north of San Francisco, which really just sort of housed a lot of young Black people, particularly those with a Panther orientation. And they used to oftentimes try to drug these young brothers in prison. And so that particular point, even though I guess I was sort of writing it tongue-in-cheek retrospectively, needs to be taken very seriously, this idea that we are crazy to want to rebel. And certainly in terms of this counter-revolutionary period that I've just articulated from 1980, hopefully coming to a screeching halt in 2020, that the whole incarceration process could be seen as an adjunct of what I wrote on page 39 of Friday's Time. And that whole incarceration process, as you know, involved a certain amount of psychological massaging, if you like. That is to say, giving people therapy to try to understand why they were rebellious, for example, or why they were not able to conform, quote-unquote, to a society based upon white supremacy. So that's the sort of resonance that quotation brings to my mind.
Do you think maybe a part of the difference in terms of why these protesters are not thought of as crazy and insane is that there's a substantial population of whites who are participating in these protests, or do you think it's something else?
Well, yeah, first of all, this was very premature. I mean, I arbitrarily ended the counter-revolutionary period on May 26th or May 25th, 2020. It's now June 30th, and so it may be premature to make even the projections I've just made. So stay tuned. But certainly the point you made is worth contemplating. That is to say, the racial and ethnic diversity of the protesters may lead to different sorts of allegations and different sorts of charges. I mean, for example, you know that the Open the Oval Office is trying to raise the specter of Antifa as being the villain of choice. Now, that's different, in a sense, from the 1960s. And, of course, Antifa, at least the stereotypical image, would not necessarily be a black face. And so that might be the response to the diversity of the protests, particularly in the Pacific Northwest, in Portland and Seattle.
I actually am calling you from Seattle, Washington, so I've been right there and catching all of President Trump's jabs about sending in the military and not allowing this sort of hooliganism to spread across the country. For folks, if you have a question for Dr. Horne, the number is 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate in this part of the world, the U.S. You were talking about this counter-revolutionary spirit that's kind of been in action since the 1980s, and at least during the protests, or I'll say for the entirety of 2020, because it started before the protests, there have been so many reports about an increase in gun sales, increase in ammunition sales, and then lots of armed white people. First, that's why I said it was before the protests, because at first they were out in your state, they were out in Texas, they were protesting about the lockdown, and we don't think the virus is real, or these restrictions are hurting businesses, and all the rest of it. And then I saw armed white people out about the looters and the protesters and the riots. Even today, minutes before we went live in your state, I saw white people out. They had signs that said, "Bars, Bar Lives Matter as they were protesting again about the business shutdowns in your state and everything. So I don't, it just to me, it seems like armed white people in public space has been a huge theme this year. Do you think that's a critical component to this counter-revolutionary force?
Oh, clearly. And that's why I'm sort of reluctant to make projections, because unfortunately I'm burdened with the knowledge of history, and I'm all too aware, well aware, of the strong counter-revolutionary current that flows through this culture. Not only what you mentioned, but just a few items. Wilmington, North Carolina, police department figures sacked a few days ago. Recall that it was about 120 years ago that you had the Wilmington Massacre, where you had an armed coup d'etat against black people, black newspapers, chased them all out of town, scores, if not hundreds, killed. Well, just a few days ago, these police officers were caught on tape basically counseling for the necessity of a so-called black genocide and a civil war to help to generate. Then, of course, I'm sure you're familiar, being in the Pacific Northwest, about the Boogaloo movement, which after the protests jumped off in Oakland, you had a Air Force sergeant with that movement who killed a officer of the law in Oakland, hoping that it would be blamed on the protester. Before that, he had killed an officer of the law in Santa Cruz, California, due south from Oakland. Now we know that this Boogaloo movement is growing, and we also know that these ultra-rightists have infiltrated police departments, of which there are 18,000 in the United States. They've infiltrated the U.S. military as well. And speaking of police departments, one of the real and present dangers we face now is the fact that the U.S. so-called Defense Department, the Pentagon, has surplus so-called military materiel, armored personnel carriers, bazookas, grenade launchers, to police departments, as if they were about to confront not civilians who don't even necessarily have a slingshot, but with the idea that they're confronting some sort of armed force, which is obviously ludicrous. We see that they're using these projectiles that are knocking out the eyes of protesters. There have been numerous cases of that. We've seen police officers use their vehicles to run down and hit various civilian protesters, peaceful protesters. So this is a very dicey situation we're facing right now, which is why I'm reluctant to call a conclusive end to this counter-revolutionary period. But it does appear that we have a respite, and we should take advantage of it, because with the global protests, hopefully we can push back successfully, at least for a while.
Context of White Supremacy, Dr. Gerald Horne. We were speaking about the current events, the protests and what have you, and particularly the video images that keep being shared. We have video footage of George Floyd, his execution, and it's lots of Eric Garner, lots of footage to pick from. You described this as kind of a pornographic exchange of these images, and I thought that was so powerful, so important. Just can you describe why you would use that particular descriptor, pornographic?
Well, it reminded me, in the sense of pornography, because some folks use pornography as a substitute for real-life human engagement, if you get my drift. And I think that these images that we're being subjected to, at least for a segment of the population, it excites them in the way that pornography excites them, and then serve as a substitute for what they might really want to engage in. And I think with regard to our community, at some point, we're going to have to calculate the psychic damage that is inflicted upon our youth, in particular, of being subjected to these images of George Floyd being lynched, Eric Garner being strangled, Philando Castile being shot, and all of the rest. I think that it'll take someone more skilled in the art and science of psychology than myself to figure out what damage this is doing to our youth.
Absolutely. Super important. And even just remind listeners, hold that. And remember what Dr. Horne just said about Wilmington, 1898 massacre. And then you can fast forward to right now, 2020, where those three officers were caught. They had video and they said, talking about the boogaloo, and we're ready to get our assault rifles. They said, we'll set them back generations. That was the transcript, not kill one or two black people. We are going to kill enough to set them back generations. That's what they said in Wilmington, North Carolina. Just one other quick point on the protest. I'm here in Seattle, so there have been a lot of white people out in the streets, a lot of non-white people, period, but lots of white people here in the Pacific Northwest, and they've been out protesting, and I've seen some folks who said, wow, this doesn't look like Watts, 1965. This doesn't even look like Rodney King, 1992, to some degree. This seems a little different, and wow, with this kind of multiracial coalition, maybe we can really get something done. And I paused. I might just be being cynical, but I said, well, I do remember, I wasn't born yet, but I do remember the 1960s. There were Students for Democratic Society, the Weathermen. There were a number of white people who became involved, Vietnam, lots of different protests that were happening. And here we are still at George Floyd. So I said, just because white people are out protesting, that does not necessarily mean that they are hitching their wagon to permanently solving this problem. Your thoughts?
Well, yeah, I think the problem, once again, to reiterate, is organizational. Pardon me, I'm not trying to make a fetish out of organization, but at the same time, I used to be involved in the anti-apartheid movement. In fact, I wrote an entire book about the U.S. role with regard to the liberation of Southern Africa, liberation from apartheid by 1994, and from colonialism in Angola and Mozambique by 1975, and from a kind of settler colonialism in what is now Zimbabwe by 1980. And so in that movement that I was involved in, I got used to building organizations. That is to say, you have committees, you have a press committee, a fundraising committee, a mobilization committee that's broken down into having a mobilizing around labor unions, around senior citizens, among college students, et cetera. And then, of course, the heads of the subcommittees become a kind of central committee. And so that's the way I was raised and trained. That's how movements all over the world have raised. Whereas in the United States right now, for reasons I've just articulated, that is to say, how centralized organizations like the Black Panther Party have been so treated so atrociously. So we sort of moved away from that, which I understand, but it's difficult for me to envision how you can keep a movement going without organization. Not just sort of the skeletal organization, which I know exists, but I mean much more of a centralized organization that, and I hope I'm not revealing my age by talking about how it used to be.
Not at all, not at all. Expertise. In looking at some of your other works, and even just kind of bridging what we're talking about right now, and some of what you have repeated in terms of why that organizational structure is not there, because in the system of white supremacy, state-sanctioned violence has done such an amazingly efficient job at mowing down particularly key pillars of those organizational structures. People like Paul Robeson, who I think many listeners said, hey, mm-hmm. we did not know a whole lot about, and that is a part of how effective they are. Not only do they sometimes jail, kill, assassinate, character assassinate these individuals while they are alive, sometimes they do such a great job they can totally redact their efforts so that most people don't even know what these people were about or what they faced. And hey, these folks are trying to fight against the exact same thing that people are protesting about right now. When we read Paul Robeson, Artist as Revolutionary, one of the major things, maybe at least for me, the most important thing that I took from that book was, wow, J. Edgar Hoover and state officials were watching this fella for many, many years. You have so many lines in the book where he's being watched and they're transcribing conversations and taping his phone. Like, What, I mean, just can you kind of share with our listeners the magnitude of scrutiny that Paul Robeson faced for most of his adult life?
Well, first of all, for those who may not be familiar, Paul Robeson was born in 1898. He passed away in Philadelphia in 1976. In between, he was a professional football player. He was a star of stage and screen. Perhaps he was a combination of Denzel Washington and Michael Jordan, so to speak. But on top of everything else, he was a political activist. And he was a political activist who also was multilingual. He studied languages as a hobby. He had speaking and or reading ability of dozens of languages because he thought it would be much more effective politically to crusade on behalf of Black Americans if he could speak to people overseas in their own tongue. In one episode in the book, I talk about how he was about to give a concert in Norway, and he began over the weekend studying Norwegian. And by the time of the concert, two or three days later, he was semi-fluent in Norwegian and therefore could speak to people in that language. So he's obviously a remarkable figure. He was routinely referred to as the tallest tree in our park. And certainly when you're a tall Black tree in a forest that white supremacy has penetrated, you can expect to receive axe chops in the form of surveillance, in the form of destabilizing of your career. As I tell the story, a turning point in Paul Robeson's life comes when he goes to the White House and confronts the President of the United States, Harry S. Truman, in the late 1940s, pressing him to do something about lynching of Black people. And Mr. Truman did not take very well to that, and it was after then that you began to see the precipitous drop, not only in the income of Paul Robeson from the mid six figures to the low four figures, but also the seizing of his passport, which prevents him from going overseas. And I mentioned a moment ago about filing a petition at the United Nations just a few days ago about systemic racism against Black people in the United States. Well, Paul Robeson did that in 1950, 1951. Which obviously did not endear him, shall we say, to Washington or to the rulers of this country. And so he had a very difficult time. It's very striking how a man could ascend such heights, but after the state decides to bring a ton of bricks down on him, he has a very difficult life as his life expires by 1976.
In your biography, this is on page 106, you write, these pressures came to head in Jefferson City, in the home state of the president, where Robeson had brought his anti-lynching crusade. There he was involved in a perilous automobile accident, but investigation revealed that four bolts had been removed from the lugs of a tire and a fifth mishandled intentionally, preordaining that Robeson's car would be diverted dangerously from its intended course. That is, only one bolt was found on the hubcap, meaning that the others had been removed and the cap then placed in such a way as to conceal this defect. Without a doubt, this was done while the car was parked, as the car had been driven only recently from St. Louis, scores of kilometers away, without incident. Yet Robeson was increasingly vilified at this point. Soon he was to be labeled Black Stalin. Thus, it was mostly the Negro press that sounded the alarm about this attempted assassination. Robeson cheats death, said the Pittsburgh Courier, as prejudice prompted an attempt on his life. Yes, it was concluded the tire on his vehicle was tampered with. Months later, Robeson was to tell the U.S. Congress bluntly, I have been threatened with death two or three times, and this incident may have been foremost in his mind. Miss Robeson was said to fear killers, adding, each night before I go to bed, I put a broad-bladed hunting knife under my pillow, along with a portable burglar alarm. The police have turned down my request for a gun permit, but I'm terrified, she added tremulously, that somebody might try to avenge themselves on me. It's many of these. I could have picked out a whole lot of these type of incidents, peak skill, lots of these. But just to underscore, like, somebody that we don't even think of, and, oh, he had a nice voice or whatever, like, no, it seems this fellow was hunted for his views and trying to replace white supremacy with justice. Additional thoughts, Dr. Horne?
Yeah, you know, as you were reading that, I was just shaking my head. I mean, because, as you know, more than most, Paul Robeson is not unique or singular in that regard. That is to say, we've had so many folks who've fallen victim to assassins' bullets, who've fallen victim to plane crashes. For example, in my book on Southern Africa, I talked about Samora Machel, the founding father of today's Mozambique. The apartheid authorities basically use a beacon to take over his airplane and direct it into a mountain, which basically killed him and his leadership, which has set back Mozambique to this very day. Now, that's just one episode amongst many. We could recite an entire litany of these kinds of despicable incidents.
Context of white supremacy. Keep that in mind when we talk about the Boogaloo and the officers in Wilmington and these whites coming out with all of their arms and what have you. That's the sort of thing that I think of when I think of this counter-revolutionary force. Very real, very serious. Let's see. One of our folks, he was with us for the book club, biography on Paul Robeson, learned a lot. Henry in Chicago, did you have a question for Dr. Horne? You should be with us.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
All right. Greetings, Gus, and greetings, Dr. Horne. I want to preface this, and I've told Gus this. I guess Gus is going to make me ask this question since we've been studying the current book, Einstein on Race and Racism, on race. And I'm a big fan of yours. I have a couple of your books. I actually met you at a lecture in New York. I've talked to you on previous radio shows. But when we were reading this book and going back to the Paul Robeson book, this current book that we're reading, Einstein on Race, it has two chapters on Paul Robeson. Now, in your book, you mentioned a lot of people in there, but we were wondering why Einstein wasn't in the book. Was that like intentional, or did you not know, or you just didn't have enough information between the interactions between Robeson and Einstein?
No, not at all. I mean, this book, first of all, you might have noticed that when the passage was being read, the word kilometers was used and not miles to describe a distance. And that's a tip-off to the fact that this was a special publication for a London publisher, and it was meant to be a brief introduction to the life of Paul Robeson. And therefore, there's a lot that's omitted through this particular biography. And so certainly I'm familiar with the relationship between Einstein and Robeson. I might have even written about that in another book. One way to do that is just to put my name, Einstein and Robeson, in your search engine, and something will probably pop up.
Okay. Thank you.
You.
Groovy caller in Chicago. And I thought it was astute reading, remembering, like, hey, was Einstein mentioned in that text? But, yeah, great point. Always getting. I'm gonna do that myself. Put it in the search engine and see what pops up. Putting that in context, the current book that we are reading, Einstein on Race and Racism, they do have two big chapters on Paul Robeson and W.E.B. Du Bois. But before you get to all of that, they have a great big chapter on the history of Princeton, and so they talk about all of the racism of Woodrow Wilson and many of the other folks, illustrious, and just how influential Princeton University has been throughout the world and the United States and even the Ivy League. This week, they decide, hey, Woodrow Wilson, we are taking your name down from their international study at the Princeton University. You did some of your undergrad work there. I'm sure you're aware of everything that's been happening. What do you make of them taking down Woodrow Wilson's name?
Well, the short answer is it's long overdue. It took them so long. The longer answer is that Paul Robeson, as you know, grew up in Princeton, New Jersey. Albert Einstein, after he left Europe, he wound up being a professor at Princeton University. And then, of course, I attended Princeton University some years ago. And one of the things I learned there, amongst other things, was, of course, the nuts and bolts of being a political activist. And we began to campaign against that racist dog, Woodrow Wilson, from the time I was there, too many years ago to mention. And listeners may know that Woodrow Wilson not only screened the racist film Birth of a Nation in the White House and praised that film. If I'm not mistaken, Thomas Dixon, the author of the novel The Klansman, on which the movie was based, was a comrade and friend of Woodrow Wilson. And we also know that Woodrow Wilson helped to purge the civil service in Washington of white people. That was one of his signal accomplishments. And I think that's one of the factors that turned the tide, along with the global protests that caused the leader of that institution to remove his name, not only from the School of Public International Affairs, but also from a residential college, which is like a collection of dormitories with its own cafeteria, et cetera. So this was a good thing. It was a victory.
There was a New York Times report today that said, not that they opposed them taking the name down, Woodrow Wilson's name down at Princeton U, but just saying that the International Center is Woodrow Wilson's vision. It'll still be his ideology and exactly what he wanted the university to be doing. It just won't have his name attached to it. So how much are we really changing if we just say we won't call it Woodrow Wilson's, the Woodrow Wilson Center anymore, but it's still going to be all of his ideology that we are cranking out in the students and doctorates that get produced? What would you make of that?
Well, I would say that that's probably an overstatement. I mean, I don't think that the putrid ideology of Woodrow Wilson in the first few decades of the 20th century could be easily transferred to Princeton. I don't think it could easily be transferred to Bob Jones University in the Carolinas, for that matter. So, but I do think that it'll still reflect a certain kind of neoliberalism, a certain kind of moderation, a certain kind of centrism that's hardly appropriate to meet the challenges of the 21st century.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Dr. Gerald Horne. When you described Paul Robeson previously, you described him as kind of a cross between Denzel Washington and Michael Jordan. To some of our younger listeners, they're thinking, like Denzel, or both of them, really, Denzel Washington, Michael Jordan. There's so many, if you read, not only your biography, but many other works, if you read about Paul Robeson, the physical characteristics, the book that we're reading right now, there's so many of those, like tall, dark, debit-like, just so many different focuses of both on his physical stature, and he was a large, strong guy, he played football, and his voice. Just can you talk about the way that he would be kind of sexual in a way that he would be described, Paul Robeson?
Yeah, he was about 6'3", about 230 to 240 pounds. He was a catcher in baseball, a forward or guard in basketball, a tight end in football. He, of course, was the prototypical Othello, speaking of Shakespeare's play, where his physicality was a primary reason for his starring in that play for so many years. But since we're raising the question of physicality, this opens the door for me to talk about the book I just finished on boxing. And, of course, there are many of those specimens when you talk about the sweet science. Most people would think about, for example, Muhammad Ali, who is, by the way, about the same size and had a similar physique to Paul Robeson. Or you might think about Jack Johnson, the heavyweight boxing champ at the turn of the 20th century, whose successes and victories led certain white supremacists to try to find a so-called great white hope, because it was found to be too psychologically and devastating otherwise to have a black man as a heavyweight boxing champion. But I also talk about a number of other boxers in the sub-genre. That is to say, Henry Armstrong, who held three titles, including welterweight and lightweight in the 1930s and 1940s. But a major theme of this book, however, is the corruption of the sport, the role of organized crime and racketeering in the sport, and the role of racism and white supremacy in the sport. And look for it maybe early next year.
Wow. What is the name of this book on boxing and racism?
The Bittersweet Science, Racism, Racketeering, and the Political Economy of Boxing.
Love it. Do you address Mike Tyson? He's one of the more prominent boxing figures the last 50 years. Mike Tyson?
Yeah, I do, because Don King is one of my characters in the book. And as you know, they're not necessarily bosom buddies. But I talk about Mike Tyson and some of his successes, some of his victories. I talk, of course, about Larry Holmes. You might recall how he really pummeled Ali in one of Ali's last fights. And then Larry Holmes had to do with the next so-called white hope, who was Jerry Cooney, who it was very interesting after Larry Holmes basically beat Jerry Cooney into a pulp. Ronald Reagan, who was the president at the time, had set up a phone connection in Jerry Cooney's dressing room because he was thinking he was going to call Cooney after he had won, but of course the phone just gathered spider webs and awful because it was not used because Holmes basically destroyed him. So I also talk about this figure who's now been forgotten by the name of Truman Gibson, who was basically working with organized crime in the 1950s when boxing was on television two or three times a week. He was a black man from Chicago, by the way. He does have a caller from Chicago. But he was working hand in glove with these mafia types. And it turns out, of course, by 1961, he's indicted. The mafia guys are sent to prison because this is his first offense. He's able to escape. But in some ways, he paves the way for Don King, who you may be familiar with, who is now in his late 80s. Truman Gibson really didn't make that much money. He was like a hired hand. Whereas Don King made a lot of money in boxing. It's really quite incredible what I detail in this book.
Wow. I am so excited. I cannot wait to read. That's a prolific author, Dr. Gerald Horne. I cannot wait to read. I did not know this. If someone had asked me, do you have any interest in boxing? I would have probably said no. But apparently, I know a little bit more than I thought. So you mentioned organized crime. So is Sonny Liston figure in there at all?
Oh, yeah, man. Because for those who are aficionados of organized crime, you may be familiar with the figure Mo Dalit, D-A-L-I-T-E. He comes out of Cleveland, moves to Las Vegas. Las Vegas, of course, becomes a happy hunting ground for organized crime. Mo Dalit also is part of the so-called Jewish mafia. Organized crime basically had two dominant wings, one Italian-American, one Jewish-American. But in one of the scenes in the book, Sonny Liston gets on the wrong side of Mo Dalit, and Mo Dalit threatens him. And then, of course, I'm sure you're familiar with the very curious circumstance of Sonny Liston's death. Sonny Liston, for those who may not be familiar, he was an early victim of Muhammad Ali. You might recall that they had this famous match in Miami in 1964. Sonny Liston was supposed to prevail. He did not, and that catapulted Muhammad Ali into the stratosphere. But in any case, Sonny Liston dies in his home in Las Vegas under very serious, very mysterious circumstances. And, of course, it's easy to speculate that his confrontation with Mo Dalit led directly to his unfortunate passing.
I am so excited to get this book. Wow. We have got to do a session. I mean, you could pick any sport, tennis, golf, football. Everything, said that before, everything leads back to white supremacy, racism, but boxing, absolutely everything leads back to white supremacy, racism. Jack Johnson, Sonny Liston, Muhammad Ali, Floyd Mayweather, it all goes back to white supremacy, racism. I see we have other callers. I'll get my last boxing question in. Just can you touch on, because it happens, it seems like generationally, there'll be these moments you just touched on where they'll have these great white hope moments or some great racial battle. Jack Johnson, he had a number of them. Back when Jack Johnson, he was becoming the first black heavyweight champion. And then Muhammad Ali, I forget the white fellow's name, who was the inspiration for the Rocky franchise. Floyd Mayweather, when he had his Conor McGregor. I think the Tyson Fury that just happened, Deontay Wilder and Tyson Fury. They have these confrontations. In a boxing match between a white fighter and a black fighter, and people will make a big deal and say, oh, wow, this is some sort of statement on racism. Sometimes they riot like they did after some of Jack Johnson's fights, and it still really doesn't resolve anything, but it just seems like they'll make a big to-do about these bouts as though it's a commentary on racism. Just your thoughts. I don't know if that comes up in the book, but it seems like there are a lot of these moments.
Well, sure, and I think in a certain sense that it was, particularly during the time of Jack Johnson, because recall that the then U.S. President, Theodore Roosevelt, whose racist statue has just been in the process of being taken down from the Museum of Natural History in Manhattan, he was president from 1900 to 1908. He, of course, styled himself as a kind of boxer, but when Jack Johnson began to ascend, he basically tried to outlaw boxing. And in fact, after Jack Johnson defeats Jim Jeffries in 1910 in Reno, Nevada, what happens is that there's an attempt to ban boxing film, because the film of that fight, and recall that film was just invented a few years earlier, the film of that fight was shown all over the country. It was felt that it was too inspiring to the Negroes. And of course, as you suggested, it led to pogroms, that is to say, attacks on black communities, because they felt that black people were getting too big of an ego from Jack Johnson's victory. But I think what happened subsequently, particularly with Muhammad Ali, you mentioned the Rocky franchise, and of course Chuck Wepner, the Bayonne leader, was in some ways the inspiration for Sylvester Stallone's Rocky. What happens is that Muhammad Ali oftentimes uses that issue in the whole race question to generate box office. Because who would come to see the Bayonne leader fight Muhammad Ali unless there was an extra element to it? And Muhammad Ali was a master and brilliant at promoting his fight. And in some ways, he took ideas from wrestling. Now, wrestling, of course, understandably, is discredited, quote, sport, unquote, nowadays. But before it was discredited, there was this wrestler by the name of Gorgeous George. I don't know if you recall him. And he used to drive a lot of people to come pay good money to watch him wrestle, because he had this sort of effete aspect. He had hairpins in his blonde hair. He would have a woman disinfect the ring with perfume before he entered it. He wore ermine and silk to the ring. But that obviously infuriated a lot of people, caused them to pay good money to watch him get beaten up. And Muhammad Ali, by his own admission, decides to use that same trick to become sort of a reviled figure so people would pay good money to come see him defeated, which, of course, rarely happens.
Context of White Supremacy. Wowee, I'm so looking forward. Dr. Horne's latest offering. I see other callers. Thank you all for indulging my boxing questions. Person dialed in from a blocked number. If you have a question for Dr. Horne, you should be with us. Just listen.
Can you hear me?
Oh, yes, sir. Well, actually, you're a little low. If you could speak up or get maybe closer to your microphone.
All right, yes. My name is Asi, and greetings to the host, and certainly greetings to Dr. Horne. I have the honor, again, to thank you, sir. You allowed me to audit one of your classes out there at the University of Houston in January of 2016. I consider you parenthetical with that aggregation of philosophers, scientists, revolutionary scholars that we know as ASCAP. Association for the Study of Classical African Civilization. I see you as, I don't know how you feel about that, but I see you, sir, as company with those great revolutionary thinkers. My question is, You mentioned earlier that there's no visible direction or visible central order to the Black Lives Matter phenomenon. And you said that you didn't say that whether that was good or bad, but you mentioned that that's somewhat different. I would think that based on what I read, what I've read out of your writing, and I've come to appreciate the central movement of Marxist populism and how it presented a tremendous threat. It was an organized international phenomenon with some kind of direction that posed some, you know, opposition, sincere opposition to the capitalist structure. Whereas now, Black Lives Matter, for all of its, you know, attraction, does not have that kind of a direction. Not quite, again, my question is it premature now? Is it premature for us to now begin to consider what order we would have should we get what we want? That is, some form of us, those of us who are struggling for freedom, and non-white people are violent in the Senate. Do you think it's premature not only for us? In other words, what I'm getting at is, sure, there's no order now, but should we be considering serious order of state in the near future, far future?
Sure. I mean, I have to ask the host to sort of summarize the question because I was having trouble making up some of the words. So could you just summarize the question?
I was struggling a bit, too. It's like your volume was going out. I heard the final portion where you said, is it premature for us to be discussing an order? And I couldn't really hear it. So if you could kind of restate your question.
Is it premature for us to begin to think about what order of state we will have so that we can protect our people?
Is it premature?
Order of state, I think he said.
Yes, in order to protect our people.
I think I understand the question. Mm-hmm. And I think, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but what the caller seems to be getting to is, you know, we have this very serious discussion about the Boogaloo movement, about the Wilmington Police Department, about police departments arming themselves. And I think the caller is talking about how do you defend yourself against that sort of thing. And that is the $64 question. I'm not sure if I should ventilate this in an open forum, but I will say, no, it's not premature to begin to discuss, certainly in private meetings, how we can defend ourselves against this repressive wave which seems to be underway.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, okay. I was just checking. Did I answer your question? Making sure I heard it correct. Did that answer your question?
Well, it did not answer it, but you cannot hear my question. So it's understandable. Basically, what I was trying to get at was Dr. Horne reflected that the Black Lives Movement does not reflect an order. It's dissipated, it's global, and it doesn't have a central direction.
I see.
And so my question is it now premature for us to not only talk about bringing some kind of order of state to a Black Lives Matter movement, but think about establishing the order of state and nation state, you know, establishing something that we want in time, because in my opinion, we will never receive protection from the United States as it's presently constructed. You know, if there's some kind of major reconstruction again, then
okay.
Perhaps we will.
I think we got the question this time. Protect. I just wanted the question. Did you hear the question? Because I think I got it that time.
Yeah, I think so. Well, first of all, with regard to the ultimate expression, the caller's probably familiar with the Republic of New Africa, which for decades now has been trying to construct what the caller might call an order of state. And I would refer the caller to the Republic of New Africa. But with regard to the Black Lives Matter movement, I think it would be worthwhile for the various chapters to think about calling a national meeting, perhaps even an international meeting, where a order and a centralized organization could be constructed so that it could be much more effective. Now, as I said, the danger there is that it opens you up to attacks from the state, which looks for centralized organizations to beat to the ground. But as we know, there are a number of centralized organizations that have been able to survive. And that's another lesson we need to study.
Thank you.
Much obliged, sir. Retired firefighter in Florida, where, just like Texas, I believe, the virus is reportedly surging. Caller in Florida, line should be open.
Greetings to the guests, Mr. Horne, Gus, and the callers. The first thing that I would want to state is that the caller that was just on the line was the motivation on my behalf to give the suggestion of Paul Robeson's book. And we have actually worked together for a quarter of a century, 25 years or more, and still stay in constant contact with one another. He and I both are retired, quote-unquote, firefighters. Yes, the first question that I have is, have you read, I was hearing somebody talk, I was hearing you guys talking about sports with concerning non-white people, non-white black males specifically. And I just wanted to know whether or not Mr. Horne, as he read the book written by William Rhodes, I believe his name was, $40 Million Slaves.
I'm familiar with the book. I haven't read it carefully, but I certainly read chapters.
Okay. Do you have any thoughts on it that you can share with us?
Well, sure. I mean, I used to read his I used to be a columnist for the New York Times, and I used to read his columns all the time. I find him very perceptive. I find him aggressive, anti-racist. Certainly, we need more analyses of sports, which is one of the reasons I tackled this question of boxing.
Okay. Yes, the last question I have is, I've been hearing the combination word, I believe it's called systematic racism. I have used the term, and some other people, if not all of the people on the COINTELPRO, have used the term global system of racism and white supremacy. Do you think that the term systematic racism is a vague combination word and vague on and being vague on purpose? The term systematic racism.
No.
As opposed to. Go ahead.
Like the United Nations used the term systemic racism. And I think that it depends on what flesh is put on the skeleton. I mean, I don't think it's so much the word, but it depends on how you flesh it out. And I'm willing to accept your friendly amendment. I'm willing to accept United Nations formulation. The question is, what comes next?
Okay. I think I understand your answer.
Okay, fair enough.
Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. One of the reasons, and Dr. Horne has many books. I reference Dr. Horne when folks pull out the rhetoric that black people are chumps and we have not fought back against racism, and that's why these type of incidents keep happening, because black people are cowards and have not fought back. I cite Dr. Horne's work regularly amongst many other people to say that is not true. There are many, 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 many examples of black people fighting back against racism. Paul Robeson recognized that that was important, to have those incidents shown to black people that we have fought back, we have been courageous. He attempted, you write in your book about his attempts to make a production of Denmark Vesey, slave revolt, South Carolina, mm-hmm. he was shut down. Can you share a little bit of that with our listeners?
Well, not only that, but he worked for the longest to produce a film about the Haitian Revolution, which is one of the most sterling parts of our life business. In fact, he did a play in London for weeks on end about the Haitian Revolution. But keep in mind that, you know, producing a film is more than a notion. I mean, one book I once wrote that if you look at cultural production, the simplest part of cultural production is like a writer with a pen and paper writing a poem. The most complex form of cultural production is producing a film, which involves oftentimes scores of workers, expensive cameras, sometimes shooting on location, actors, a screenplay, etc. It's a major capital investment. And you should also infer from what I just said that given that capital investment, it's probably more difficult to produce a film that's worthwhile, and it's also more difficult to produce a film that has progressive content. Whereas if you're just writing a poem with a piece of paper that you're going to declaim at a slam poetry event, it's much simpler to be progressive.
Certainly difficult. I know Spike Lee has talked about some of those same difficulties in film. In fact, going back to boxing, he wanted to do Joe Louis and Max Schmeling, and he ran into a lot of the same problems in trying to get that production done. I believe we have a caller in Norway, Kamal. I would have brought him in on my line, but I didn't see, so I'm thankful he was able to figure it out. I believe this is Kamal in Norway. If you are with us, I think I have to put the timestamp on this. So if this is Kamau in Norway, it would be 3:14 a.m. Yikes. Are you there, sir?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Crystal clear. Proceed.
Oh, perfect. Yes. I woke up at 2 o'clock yesterday morning for this show. Then I figured it out and got my together and to bed early and so I could wake up for this show today. It's a little bit difficult sometimes, but I have read the introduction and the epilogue of Fire This Time. It's very it's very good reading. It's very detailed. It's very thorough. It's every paragraph seems to have a lot of information. So I'd like to thank Professor Horne for his work and thank you, Gus, for bringing him on and introducing him to us. I've, like, found about 6 of his books that I want to start reading. I've written a bunch of notes, but the most important one, and forgive me if you've already answered this question, Professor Horne, what would be your definition of racism?
Well, I think that the host just gave a definition that I acceded to, so the host might want to repeat that.
Oh, yeah, I did ask him the normal definition I use, global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white, covered at the beginning.
Okay. Good. Next question. In Fire This Time, you referred to the interracial left and the combination of the protests in Los Angeles in California being a combination of different groups from the 40s to the 60s, and that, you know, it lost some of the support that it had before, but and then that it ended up being a Nation of Islam and the cultural nationalists and another kind of group. But you refer to this term called narrow black nationalism. Why call it that if it is black people who are representing black people as compared to is it that because that you're comparing it that to the communist party that was advocating for black people in the 40s?
Well, I think that's a fair point that you're raising. But keep in mind that many people, we were just saluting Paul Robeson. And Paul Robeson, of course, was a global figure. He was an international figure. He was, when he filed that petition at the United Nations with regard to genocide against black people, he was doing it on behalf of the Civil Rights Congress, which was, in fact, an interracial organization. There were many people who were critical of the Civil Rights Congress precisely because it was an interracial organization. I mean, if people want to come out into the streets and protest against the lynching of George Floyd, I think people should come out to the streets and protest against the lynching of George Floyd, not least because there are many black people who don't want to come out into the streets. Clarence Thomas is not going to come out to the streets and protest against the lynching of George Floyd. And so at a certain point, I think we have to take support where we can get.
Okay, so then you're not really firm on the term black nationalism. What's your take on this concept of black nationalism?
Well, it depends on what you mean by that. I mean, for example, I've written about Marcus Garvey, I've written about Martin Delaney in the 19th century. I've written about the boxers, Muhammad Ali, and as a matter of fact, one of the theses that I put forward in this book on boxing is that because boxing had been dominated by organized crime, that you had many boxers who were exploited because of that. And when Muhammad Ali affiliated with the Nation of Islam, in some ways, it helped to prevent him from being exploited to the same degree as other boxers were. So I think what we need to realize is that it depends upon what these organizations are doing as much as anything else.
Thank you very much. And, Gus, if you permit me one last question. I just came in, so I'll catch the first hour of the show. But one thing I noticed in prior this time is that even from the 50s to the 60s in California, I've noticed that there's, of course, a cyclical nature to these events and then the protests. But I know, is it your observation that there's a bit of, in organizations, we talk about organizational memory and how it's important to keep it and how you might lose it when people leave the organization or leave the country and so on. But would you not observe that there is a protest memory that can be lost in these kind of organizations? Even right now, I saw on Facebook that someone put a picture of saying that from the 92 riots where they said the different year, same problem. And this is a post. This was on a poster in a protest. Same year, different year, same problem. But this is in 92. So the point that this person on Facebook was making last week was that this was 28 years ago they had the same poster, and that same poster could be used today. Different year, same problem. But some of the protest memory seems to be lost. What's your observation and commentary on that?
Well, sure. I mean, that's why some of us try to write history, so that these memories are not lost. But it's difficult because, you can write history, but then there's an old saying that if you want to keep a secret, you publish it in a book. That is to say that oftentimes people don't read, or they go to school and they're turned off and alienated and then leave school and therefore don't have the ability to even read. So, it's a very difficult process, no doubt.
All right, then. Give me a bonus question, Gus.
Hang on one sec. Well, I guess he said no. Wait, never mind. Sorry, never mind.
It's really tiny. It's really tiny.
Yes, sir.
How often are you included to these where you're called to a TV program where you're asked to be on a panel of young of people where they're asking you for your insight. Yeah, I noticed a lot of these panels have relatively young people or relatively active people in the moment, but not very many historians or professors or people who have been active before. I mean, are you being called? Would you like to be called? Thank you so much for your work. I'm in my line.
He says, would I like to be called for what now?
To do interviews, to do television interviews, to talk about your work and white supremacy.
Oh, yeah, all the time. Especially nowadays with the pandemic, I'm easy to find.
Okay. I was going to say, I've seen a lot of content of Dr. Horne, Rolling Stones, and all kinds of folks have been calling him. Yeah. No shortage of Dr. Horne available to give his views on white supremacy racism. Let's see. The person, I guess you're on the VOPE line. If you're on the VOPE line with a question for Dr. Horne, your line should be open. Proceed.
Yes. Hello to Gus and Dr. Horne and the listeners and callers. I had a question regarding organization, and we talk about organization, but my question is, I have three brief questions. My first question is, haven't we already done organization and speak glowingly about it, Dr. Horne, but it didn't really resolve our problems? So I'd like to ask that question. Number two, as a historian, during the civil rights movement, I think that you do have some direct experience with involvement in the civil rights movement, I think. And I'd like to know, what do you think the mistakes, the major mistakes that we made? In other words, we're here again. So, in retrospect, what do you think the mistakes that we made then? Number three, fascism. Just wanted to know, do you think that we are on the verge or have entered a stage of what I'll call fascism? And if so, if your answer is yes, what similarities, patterns
to
support that?
Well, let me take the last question first. I would say that fascism is always a possibility in a country like this. But I will not say at this particular moment we're enduring fascism, because if that was the case, we wouldn't be able to have this conversation right now. What would happen is that a stormtrooper would break down the door of the host and hit him in the head, drag him off, put him in a cellar somewhere. And that's not happening. So I don't think we should misjudge and misestimate the political moment, because that can lead to harebrained strategy and inappropriate tactics. With regards to mistakes that we've made, I would say the major mistakes that we've made have been not maintaining international relations. I mean, it's very difficult for me to think of any organization or individual who has an understanding of what's going on in the world and then can apply that to the domestic situation, who can interpret the U.S. conflict with China, the U.S. recent rifts with the European Union, the relationships with Russia, the relationships with the Caribbean, Brazil, Africa, and then try to translate that into what's going on in the street. Most folks in this country, they don't do that sort of thing, although it's routine that you do that overseas. And what that means is that it's for trout. You sort of think the whole world is like the United States, or you think that everybody is, just because all these people in the United States are so backwards and retrograde, you think everybody around the world is backwards and retrograde. I mean, for example, in my 16th century book, I talk about the difference between black people in Cuba and black people in what is now the United States. And a lot of it has to do with settler colonialism in Spain, in Cuba, Spanish Cuba, which is different from settler colonialism that we experience now that we're speaking English. But oftentimes black people, they go to Cuba and they think that black people in Cuba had the same experience that we did in the United States, which is not altogether accurate. And let's see, what was the first question? The first question was, oh, yeah. Yeah, sure. I mean, if I heard you correctly, you were saying, well, you, Professor Horne, you're counting organizations, but we're in trouble. So obviously organization hasn't worked very well. Well, I would say this, that we would be worse off if there was an organization. That's what I would say. It would be like saying, well, because there have been no fires lately, you should get rid of the fire department. Well, no, I don't think so. And likewise, just because we're not necessarily doing as well as we should be now, well, I think we'd be doing better if we had stronger organization. And I think that one of the reasons we were able to emerge from both the horrors of slavery and the horrors of Jim Crow was precisely because of organization. And now to try to reduce the usual comeback is to try to say, well, we're still a slave. Well, no. I mean, you can draw parallels between the situation today and slavery, but it really does a disservice to the horrors that our ancestors suffered to say that we are going through now what they did in 1830.
That answered your questions, ma'am?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Horne. I have two of your books. Thank you, guys.
For sure, for sure.
Thank you.
Such a large body of work. I did the search as recommended by Dr. Horne. Einstein put his name in, and then Paul Robeson. He mentions Einstein's relationship and with W.E.B. Du Bois, who has a whole chapter as well in the book we're reading right now in Black and Red, W.E.B. Du Bois and the Afro-American Response to the Cold War, 1944 to 1963. Pops up quite a few times in there. We haven't even got to the Du Bois section of the book yet. Talking about your enormous body of constructive work, all of which seems to deal with white supremacy racism, all roads lead back. You also wrote about the deepest South, the United States, Brazil, and the African slave trade. We have been paying a lot of attention, including having guests on from Brazil to talk both about COVID-19. They now have the second most number of cases and deaths in the world, only trailing the United States. And protests about racism, at least all of the reports that I've seen, I don't think George Floyd's name has been mentioned because they kill a lot of black people in Brazil anyway, so they don't have to steal names of black victims from the U.S. They have plenty of victims in Brazil. Can you kind of put what's happening in Brazil in the context of your studies, The Deepest South?
Well, that book, The Deepest South, is about the fact that Brazil has the largest black population outside of Nigeria, and a lot of it has to do with U.S. slave traders in the 1840s in particular, who were raiding Angola and Mozambique in particular and dragging Africans across the Atlantic to be enslaved in Brazil. Now, with regard to what's happening in Brazil today, of course, the President Bolsonaro dubs himself as the Trump of the tropics. He's taken a rather cavalier approach to COVID-19, describing it as being something of a mild flu at one point, or a flu of some sort, I should say. And as a result, COVID-19 is ripping through Brazil just the way it's ripping through Texas. And it's devastating Brazil right now. And let us hope that it weakens Mr. Bolsonaro politically, just like I'm hoping that COVID-19 weakens the Oval Office, Agent Orange himself politically.
Wow. I'm not sure. I know it's been strikingly similar. Just if we can touch on that, because you're noting the similarities in terms of President Trump downplayed the virus quite a bit here as well. And it seems strikingly similar. And then these are the two, unless I'm misinformed, the two countries with the highest population of black people in this hemisphere, the United States and Brazil. And it seems the virus response has been strikingly similar, strikingly pathetic, equally in both areas.
Oh, clearly. And you know, for similar reasons, it's not only the endemic racism that you find in both countries and in both societies, it's also the sort of free market ideology and the idea that government itself is the problem, as Ronald Wilson Reagan said decades ago, and therefore there's a poor public health infrastructure, a poor public hospital. As a matter of fact, one of the problems you have in the United States, and to a certain extent in Brazil as well, is that people right now are afraid to go to hospitals, even if they have heart problems, gunshot injuries, because they think that their fate will be worse going to a hospital where they'll catch the virus. And so I don't even think that the trust has begun to look at the ancillary deaths that have come from people not going to the hospital for treatment and dying as a result.
Wow. That is, and that would count for both areas, but I've seen a number of reports of even for young children where parents, we have, you know, parents who listen to the program, where parents citing those concerns have not taken their children in for checkups or to get shots or whatever it might be because of those same concerns. So, yeah, I mean, lots of the collateral damage is untold worldwide from this in many different respects. Also, body of work, man, we say on the program, reading is more important than watching television. We say that all the time. We have a book club, try to promote as much reading as possible. Woo, Dr. Horne, you could be reading for weeks and weeks and months. If you need some literature, get more information about white supremacy as a global system, Dr. Horne has got you. Race war, white supremacy, and the Japanese attack on the British Empire. Even with the rhetoric about the Chinese virus and all of President Trump's rhetoric about China and all of this, even that, for me at least, comes a lot back to racism, white supremacy, and a lot of this conflict with China. Do you have thoughts on that, Dr. Horne?
Well, there's a real fear right now in Washington and on Wall Street that China's in the passing lane, and that the Chinese economy might already be larger than the United States economy, and what that will mean for the ability of the United States and its allies to dominate the world. And as a result, there is a distinct possibility, I'm afraid to say, there could even be a military conflict between the United States and China, because the United States sees its advantage slowly evaporating, but it still has an advantage militarily over China. And, of course, it owes China trillions of dollars, the People's Bank of China, by U.S. Treasury bills, which is basically a loan to the United States, so we can support everything from the Pentagon to the post office. And if the United States wages war successfully against China, won't have to pay the money back. So this is a real dangerous and volatile situation, which in some ways is made even more complicated by the use of such terms as the Wuhan flu and Kung flu and these other distasteful terms that Mr. Trump routinely employs.
I think a lot of that rhetoric, the Kung flu, and it comes from China, and that sort of, in my view, racist, white supremacist rhetoric, I could easily see that becoming a part of the boogaloo, already is in many respects, this, as you call it, this counter-revolutionary force that could not only lead to some sort of military conflict with China, I could see this having some really long-term ramifications, even beyond. I could see that being a part of how he ends up getting another four-year term, like lots of devastating things happening if people take that threat seriously to a loss of white power, U.S. dominance in the world. Is that being alarmist? Kind of what you were saying before, kind of being alarmist, or is that being logical?
No, I don't think it's being alarmist at all. I mean, you cited my book about the Pacific War between Japan and the United States, 1941 to 1945, which ended with the United States using atomic weapons against Hiroshima and Nagasaki, August 6th, August 9th, 1945. That shows, of course, those atomic bombs basically killed civilians, tens of thousands, at one fell swoop. And that shows you the depth to which these rulers in Washington will think if they feel that their misrule is being threatened, particularly by
an Asian power,
Particularly by an Asian power. Highlight, boldface print. Wow. I see the other caller. I just want to get in really quick. At least for me, from what I've seen, news reports, I think we're going to have another 4 years of our current president, just based on what I'm seeing. I do not foresee a November celebration for Mr. Biden. What's your view on how the election is looking at this point?
Well, you know, I won't argue that point because the polls have been proven to be unreliable. I recall November 2016, and I recall I was on the East Coast then, and I was looking at the New York Times site, and it had Hillary Rodham Clinton ahead as of, 8:45 p.m., then by 9 p.m., Donald Trump was declared the president. And that shows you the emptiness and the unreliability of these polls, which now show Mr. Biden ahead by double digits. And in any case, Michael Dukakis was ahead and George H.W. Bush by double digits at this point in 1988. So it's too soon to say. It's too soon to say, in my opinion.
Willie Horton reference? Did we get a Willie Horton reference in for the program? My goodness. Pivoting to the... Is that important enough to warrant Willie Horton? Because that was a big part of the turning point in that election with Mr. Dukakis. Yes? Racism, white supremacy strikes again?
Oh, absolutely, bro. Yeah, he hammered Dukakis, the former governor of Massachusetts, with these ads about this black man, Willie Horton. Governor Dukakis presumably given some sort of prison furlough, and then Willie Horton supposedly attacked this Euro-American woman. It was a real devastating political commercial, and it helped to turn the tide for H.W. Bush.
I think it's online. You can check YouTube. If you just put in Willie Horton, you should be able to see the historic parlance of political history. Let's see. The caller 9401, fellow podcaster. You should be with us if you have a question for Dr. Horne.
Good evening. Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. Good evening, everyone. My question is, and I hope it makes sense. So I know earlier, I think Dr. Horne was talking about, I think, Burkina Faso appealing to the UN to look into, I guess, racism, white supremacy in America. And so, and he said that didn't go anywhere. My question to Dr. Horne is, why do you think it's constructive to petition an organization that has a racist foundation to get justice for black people?
I think we it's like saying, should you go to court in the United States to sue for damages like Ben Crump is doing on behalf of Trayvon Martin and George Floyd and a host of other deceased litigants? I can't think of any institution that's more racist than the U.S. courts, but I certainly salute Ben Crump for going into those courts and trying to extract justice. So, yes, I think that the Burkina Faso and the African Union should be going to the United Nations on our behalf. Mr. Trump has increased the number of enemies that the United States has in the international community. Iran just called for his arrest, for example, and alerted Interpol and international police to help them in that regard. And I think it would be folly to ignore such bodies. And in any case, just to clarify, what happened with the Burkina Faso resolution was that it didn't lead to a commission of inquiry into the, quote, systemic racism, unquote, the United States of America, but it will lead to further investigations, and it's up to us to try to keep the pressure on. And as I said, when I was talking about this some days ago, a lot of people didn't even know about it. They consider themselves to be activists and well-informed.
Yeah, I think my doubt about the situation is that, from what I understand, I think America is a major contributor for the UN. So, you know, like, why would that body, you know, go against the U.S.? I've hardly seen the UN go against the U.S. I've heard about that thing too, like Iran, putting out the arrest because the execution of the general. But, you know, that's all I have to say. That's just easy too. Thank you for answering my question.
Fair enough.
Much obliged. A number again, Dr. Horne, last few moments with us, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943, pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Please don't wait till the last second if you have a question that you know you want to get in, if you heard something of interest and want to get a little bit more detail from Dr. Horne. I was a little slow before, and maybe some listeners need to make sure that they get the book title down. Can you give us the title of the boxing book one more time, Dr. Horne?
Oh, it's not out yet, so I mean, I can give it, but it won't be published till next year.
Oh, man, that's a long time to wait. My goodness. Oof, we have to hope.
Yeah, it finished a few days ago.
Wow, I had no idea. Okay, I thought this was something that was pending, like, end of the year or something. Wow, so this is like, press is still warm and just, okay, wow, okay, well. Hopefully we can, we'll make it through the Rona, we'll get to 2021, and that'll be one thing that we can be excited for next year, Dr. Horne's new book. Can we at least get the title so we'll know what to look out for?
Oh, sure. It's The Bittersweet Science, and of course the play upon calling boxing the sweet science. So I deal a lot with the bitter aspects.
Spectacular. We'll be on the lookout for folks coming in for our making sure we did not miss anybody. Or, never mind. Sorry. 0636-0636. If you had a call or question for Dr. Horne, you should be with us. Caller 0636.
Yeah. Peace, Gus T, and peace, Dr. Horne.
Thanks.
I wasn't able to peep all of it, but appreciating what I've heard, and we'll make sure to peep out the archive. My question is about this current phase of struggle and this issue of abolitionism. And you were mentioning about parallels that are drawn to our enslavement in previous periods. And I was just wondering if you could speak to, especially with your legal background, if you could speak to the abolitionism that's going on with regard to the 13th Amendment exception clause, and if, in your view, that struggle, this phase of abolitionist struggle, should also draw from the international framework that you speak to in your work historically, where heads have done what they could to shift the correlation of forces, or you speak of racial arbitrage and these kinds of strategies with regard to struggles against enslavement. What are your thoughts on how that could be adopted as a strategy in today's struggle against enslavement, particularly prison slavery?
Well, once again, I think that black people in the United States have to come to this conclusion, it seems to me. On the one hand, we can all talk until the cows come home about the death and the putrid nature of white supremacy in the United States of America. But if we're going to combat it, historically, what's happened is trying to adopt the simple principle of international relations that every other people, every other nation adopts, but seems to have eluded many of us, which is that the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And so, therefore, if the United States has antagonists and enemies abroad, and they're all under one roof at the United Nations, then it makes good sense to try to use that leverage against the United States as opposed to finding excuses as to why you shouldn't use that leverage. By the way, the United States is a major contributor to the United Nations, and you might have noticed that the Oval Office just said that in the middle of the pandemic, he's trying to withdraw the United States from the World Health Organization, which is headed by the Ethiopians, interestingly enough, which is like throwing the pilot out of the plane in the middle of flight. But you also might have noticed that to make up the shortfall, a number of governments have already come forward to say that they're going to up their contribution to this United Nations affiliate organization known as the World Health Organization. So folks should not paint themselves into a corner. I mean, I know we've been beaten down, and that leads to defeatism, and you think you can never get yourself out of this hole, and so therefore you remain in the hole. But trust me, you know, we wouldn't be where we are today if our ancestors had said, oh, woe is me. You know, Britain is a slavery country, United States is a slavery country, France is a slavery country. There's nothing we can do. You know, let's just pick some more cotton. No, that wasn't the approach. And I don't think that should be the approach today. And so with regard to this so-called prison industrial complex, this system of mass incarceration, well, I'm sure you're familiar since you invoked the 13th Amendment about Ava DuVernay's film 13th. And if you haven't seen it, I recommend it because it shows the close connection between the abolition of slavery and the rise of the slavery substitute, the prison industrial complex, flowing out of the 13th Amendment, which has led inevitably to this movement to not only defund police, abolish the police, which it seems to me is going to lead inevitably to a movement to do something similar to the U.S. military as well, and to take that $900 billion that goes to the U.S. military and apply it to health care, to reparations, to education, et cetera. So that's a partial response to your intelligent question.
Much obliged, good sir. Caller in New York. Before we run out of time, I wanted to make sure I asked, just is it possible we could get more detail just about what you were doing with your work with the Black Panther Party back in California?
Well, this was when I was in law school. And so I was volunteering at their office out in East Oakland. I was teaching courses at Vacaville State Prison, as already noted. I don't think I was writing for the newspaper, although I do remember I was writing for Muhammad Speak then, the Islam newspaper. So I was in law school at that time, so it's not like I was working full time. I mean, this was just volunteering.
Wow. How long did you write for the NOI?
Oh, if you go back and look at issues from, I'm going to age myself. From 1972 and 1973, you'll find a number of articles that I wrote because I'd gone down. I wrote some articles about my travel because I was traveling in South America. I'd gone to Chile under Salvador Allende then. I remember writing an article about Uruguay. You can find it. You'll find my byline there. And dig up some newspaper on microfilm.
Wow. If the Rona leaves us alone and we are ever allowed to go back to the library, wow, that'll be a great little research project. Wow. Dr. Horne, such an amazing author. You can also dig or grab The Counter-Revolution of 1776, Slave Resistance, and the Origins of the United States of America. This is one that I talk about regularly. I'll reference when people say black people are lames. Black people are cowards. We've never fought back. That's the problem. White people keep doing these things because black people don't fight back. And see, that is a really offensive lie because there are so many black people who have fought back and done all kinds of things. Denmark Vesey, we already got mentioned. Since we have him here, just can you give a word about why this is such an important book to read while we read on your boxing text, The Counter-Revolution of 1776?
Well, because July 4th is approaching. And or the 4th of July, as some might have it. And that's really the beginning of this creation myth, this immaculate conception idea, the founding of the United States of America, which has helped to generate a tidal wave of mythology and lies about how this country was founded. And to the extent that you accept even a scintilla of that creation myth and lie, then you can be misled, or you'll be like certain politicians who, whenever there's a travesty and a tragedy, such as a man being lynched on camera, and as the police officer has his hands in his pocket, certain politicians will say, well, that's not who we are. Who we are is the so-called alleged founding principle, which is really just ridiculous. It's demobilizing. It's propaganda. And it helps to fortify a defeatist attitude, seems to me.
How does that fortify a defeatist attitude, saying, you know, this is not who we are?
because I think it cultivates illusion, because this is who we are. And if you don't know the truth, then it becomes easier to be defeated, and it becomes easier to be misled. And knowing the truth is the first step towards digging yourself out of this hole, this deep hole in which we find ourselves. Whereas if you believe the mythology, if you believe the hype, it seems to me you're well on your path, well on the way to being defeated.
Mm. Very important point. Accurate information. Accurate information. That, the role of historians, journalists, very important to get accurate information so that we can accurately grasp the problem, go about finding a solution. The folks that are with us, did we get everybody satisfied? They got their question in for the day?
Oh, is that to me?
I was just making sure we didn't miss anyone. I didn't want to miss.
I have a question real quick.
Oh, let's see.
Dr. Horne, what is that book that you wrote? Can you hear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. That book on Marcus Garvey that you have written, what's it called?
Well, no. I haven't written it. I wrote about him on my book. You look at my book, Facing the Rising Sun. African-American,
okay.
The Rise of Afro-Asian Solidarity.
Yeah.
I write about him.
I saw it online. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Good luck.
Let's see.
I have a question.
Our caller in Norway is still with us. That is amazing.
Oh, my God. I guess phone calls.
You guys don't. Well, I'm calling through this amazing thing that Gus has set up. And, I've been reading your work for the past 2 years, and it's the first time I heard about it. I really appreciate your work. It was amazing to see the information and counter revolution that actually the Haitian independence assisted ending slavery. That was really new information for me as well. And I also saw this information that civil rights was also won as a result of how the U.S. would. Because of international relations in the U.S. and the Cold War, connecting civil rights to the Cold War, I will be reading more of work about that. I think part of the difficulty happens because you see that white supremacy is so good to change its tactics, once it has to update or refine its behavior. So slavery ends, and then you have Jim Crow, and then people think, oh, this is still here. So, probably could comment on that, but my real question is, like, I've understood that there have been times when you've written up to 3 books.
Dr. Horne is about to exit, and I think one more person might have had a question, so if you can just kind of distill it, maybe
okay.
In 30 seconds to your question.
How do you write so much? I mean, if you've written 3 books a year, that means you write in 4 pages a day, and then you have to be reading as well. How do you work as a scholar, sir?
Well, I go to bed early as soon as I hang up the phone. I'm going to bed. I'll get up about 4, read newspapers, hard copies, and then read some online. Then, because of the pandemic, I can't go out to archives, so I'll do some online research for about 4 hours. And then I'll read for about 3 or 4 hours. And then I'll watch some documentaries or movies, and then go to bed.
Amazing. Amazing. How many newspapers, hard copy newspapers, do you read daily?
Well, the dailies are New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, USA Today, Houston Chronicle. Then I get in the mail the Washington Post and the LA Times. Then I get a lot of black newspapers, Final Call, LA Sentinel, New York Amsterdam News. And then, of course, magazines, Economist, Business Week, London Review of Books, Times Literary Supplement, on and on and on. New York Amsterdam News, did I mention that?
Yes, sir. Wow. Reading is more important than watching television. Reminds me of Dick Gregory, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. They had really impressive reading lists. Our last call before we let Dr. Horne get some Z's, 0747-0747. Did you have a question for Dr. Horne?
Yes. Real quick, greetings, Gus, and thanks for participating, Dr. Horne. I've read a couple of your books and always love your conversation. My question, with all your long career and how you speak very clearly about racism, white supremacy, have you ever, through the Freedom of Information Act, looked into whether the FBI or any of these governmental groups have looked into you or did any investigations or dossiers on you?
No, I haven't. I'll leave it to somebody else to do that for me. But I haven't done it for myself, no. That's all. Thank you.
Right on. Dr. Horne, what was the book that you recommended talking about white supremacy in the Pacific? I know Race War. I got that one. I thought I heard you mention a different book as well.
I wrote a book. I've written a number of books about the Pacific. One is Race War. Another is Facing the Rising Sun, which deals with Japan and World War II. And another is The White Pacific, which I'm happy to say is very popular amongst our brothers and sisters in Fiji, Australia, and New Zealand, who oftentimes feel neglected by the rest of the black world.
Wow. Lots to read. I'm a little bit bummed, but we will see if we can hang in there. If we get through the Rona and everything, we'll be alive when The Bittersweet Science is published. Man, I'm so excited. We'll have to see if we can get you back on the program to come in and chat that up. I'm so eager. That'll be my first book that I'm super excited about for 2021, but lots of extraordinary scholarship from Dr. Horne. Such a privilege to have you on the broadcast. Thanks so much for all of your hard work for all of these years. Go back, see if I can get some of those Nation of Islam articles as well. But thanks so much for coming in to share some of your time and insight with us this evening. I'm sure listeners appreciate it as well. Please keep up your fantastic work, good sir.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Oh, for sure. We will wish you good luck and stay safe down there in Texas. We will speak soon. Take good care. Get good rest this evening.
All right. Thank you. Good luck. Bye-bye.
Yes, sir. Context of White Supremacy. Dr. Gerald Horne, prolific author, prolific reader. Man, have to do some more studies. I can't believe we've only read one of his books. Thus far, I'm definitely looking at the counter-revolution of 1776. July 4th, right there, days away. Really good one. I am super excited about the boxing book as well. I mean, he has so many books. Like, geez. Anybody, if you're missing out, I know some other folks are saying that they were looking for reading material. I'll get people who will say, hey, what are, you know, five or six books that, you know, you think people should really read if they're serious about racism and wanting to get additional information and think are great. Like, I'm always a little surprised when I get that because I feel like, wow, the number of books that we recommend on the program is pretty high. In addition to the number of books that I will place emphasis on and say, oh, wow, Medical Apartheid is spectacular in my top 10, or trying to think of some of the other books that I've said, Delectable Negro. I think there are quite a few that I've said, oh, wow, this one is particularly good. But we mentioned a lot of books. Anybody, if you feel like your counter-racism library is a little skimpy, you're missing out, looking for something to read, put Dr. Horne's name in. You should find at least 3, 4, 5 texts. They should all be about white supremacy, racism, and you should learn quite a bit. Like the Brazil, we talked about that today. Paul Robeson, we got that. Man, Haitian Revolution, lots and lots and lots. Depends on, you know, whatever your interest is, you can learn about white supremacy, racism with Dr. Horne's library. I'll get some of the folks who dialed in if they have any questions, thoughts that they want to share based on what they heard today. Just number one, our caller in Chicago, Henry, I would have happily asked Dr. Horne about, you know, Einstein's inclusion or omission. The only reason I did not was I thought that was such a great question. I, you know, was so lazy I'd forgotten about whether or not Einstein was mentioned. But yeah, I thought, yeah, if you remember, you should definitely stand up and get your classroom gold star for remembering. And I thought that was great, the insight that he gave with the response about that being a specific publication, London publication, and just trying to be kind of a shorter summary of some of Paul Robeson's life and travails and accomplishments and such, and not a more comprehensive analysis of his life and times. So, great question, great response, good memory, good memory. Let's see, anything else from... I did not know, I was in the group when Dr. Horne was talking about the resolution in Burkina Faso to go before the United Nations to get an investigation with regards to systemic white supremacy or systemic racism in the U.S. I had not heard about that resolution, so I was in the group that Dr. Horne was talking about. Although I have heard a few of those resolutions or proposals before, I think, you know, I gave my opinion, my concluding opinion about that 2016 or 2014, because I think something similar happened with Ferguson, Eric Garner, Michael Brown Jr., where the United Nations, they made a report of some sort and talked about racism, but I mean, they don't have a military force. They don't have nuclear weapons to say, you know, you're going to do right by niggers, or we are going to, you know, bomb you all to kingdom come and all the rest of it. Like, they don't really have an enforcement edge, although I definitely see the importance of talking about this as a global problem. And that's why we have our caller in Norway with us today. That's why I was going to try to say, well, wait a minute, because he said he had one more question. I was going to say, well, wait a minute, we got other folks, and to make sure we get everybody in. And then I stopped and said, wow, I did the whole time stamp for a reason. Like, it is, let's see if I can do it now. So it's 9-hour time difference for me, so that means it would be 4:04 a.m. in Norway. Woo! That's why. See, yeah, let me shut up. Sorry. My apologies. I'll be quiet. Get your question in. If anybody was going to stay awake until 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning to dial a radio program to discuss white supremacy racism, yes, I will hush and allow that person to get a question or 5 in. Anyway, folks have any thoughts what they heard from Dr. Gerald Horne, prolific reader and author?
Can I hear it?
Caller in Chicago. Great question. Wasn't that a great answer?
Yes, it was. Yes, it was. I was afraid Dr. Horne was going to dance around it, but he did give an excellent answer to it. So I really appreciate him. That's why I'm a big fan of his. But you know, one of the things he discussed about was his article in Muhammad Speaks, and it's strange because now I get the connection because I read The Final Call myself, and there are articles in The Final Call that references Dr. Horne's work a lot. So maybe that is why, you know, they reference, you know, his work a lot, or what he says a lot. And Gus, one of the interesting books that Dr. Horne wrote was a book called The Color of Fascism. It's a short book, actually. It's not even, I don't think it's like 200 pages, but I remember reading a couple of years ago. And it was about a guy named Lawrence Dent. And he's like a U.S. fascist, whatever that means. But he was a guy who, I think he had a white parent and a non-white black parent, but he passed as a white man. So I thought his biography was pretty interesting in that perspective. But, you know, take a look at it, see if that'll be interesting to do for the book club. But that's all I have on the topic.
The Color of Fascism, Lawrence Dennis, Racial Passing, and the Rise of Right-Wing Extremism in the United States. Interesting. Reminds me of J. Edgar Hoover, we had the program where they talked about kind of the same thing, him perhaps having a non-white parent and a white parent, and that being a part of the motivation to drive him to practice white supremacy racism so ruthlessly, to make sure that he maintained his status as, or his classification as a white man, but him being the architect of the COINTELPRO operation and perhaps assassination, Fred Hampton was mentioned and all the rest of it. But The Color of Fascism, Dr. Gerald Horne. Add that one to the list. We'll see if we get that in the book club between now and when the Sweet Science, the Bitter Sweet Science comes out next year. Henry in Chicago, much obliged, sir. Other folks dialed in? Thoughts, observations?
Yes, sir.
Retired five.
Gerard?
Yes, sir. I thought I heard him mention that he wrote a book somewhere within the subject on Muhammad Ali. Is that correct?
I believe he did say that. Yep.
Yeah. He didn't say what was the style. Was it an autobiography, or was it just talking about his quote unquote political background or something like that? He didn't say specifically what it was about.
I don't think he gave the title. But I mean, he went into enough, it would have to be politics, because he was talking about, and his connections to the Nation of Islam, that, you know, I thought was a solid point, which
okay.
In Chicago, he was talking about how his affiliation with the Nation of Islam, that helped him from being cheated, to some degree in his boxing career and all that. So I would assume it would contain information of that sort. But yeah, I don't think he gave the full title of it. I was checking, sites to see if I could find a title. If I find it, I will share.
Yeah, good. I think that has soothed my curiosity by reading that book until the new book about quote unquote boxing in general that he wants to talk about will come out. One thing that a lot of times questions don't come up until the guests leave the program. And I was thinking, because he mentioned something about that he either was writing or had wrote a book about the place that is called Japan and its reference to as a non-white group of people in the waging of war with the place that's called the United States. And one of the most popular slogans, and it still is used today, is the sneak attack on Pearl Harbor. And I was just wondering, I envision it as a quote-unquote propaganda slogan, because I don't think it was a sneak attack. but I just thought it was used to be able to galvanize and encourage a whole lot of white people to join the military forces to do what they eventually did with the Japanese people. And I was wondering on what his thoughts was on that, on my thinking, he wrote a book on the subject matter, or something that has to do with the subject matter anyway. And what would his thoughts would be? That would have been another question that I possibly would have asked. Yes.
Maybe we can get him back on the program, and you can get the opportunity. I'm definitely excited for the boxing book. I'm still looking to see if I can find the Muhammad Ali. I don't know if he said specifically it was a book or an article, but I'll see if I can find it. He seems pretty receptive. Like he has the record, I think, for the fastest response to a program invitation. Like, I think he responded in a matter of, it might have been seconds. Like, it was almost instantaneous from the time I hit sends. Like, pow, sure. What dates are you thinking about? Like, maybe you could drop him an email, even say, hey, I heard you on that, you know, program, and you're talking about Muhammad Ali, and
he
might just hit you back, and, you know, if it's an article, he might even just send it to you directly.
Yeah, that's true. Why should you have to do all of the work? I can do that myself.
Woo-hoo,
yeah.
Woo-hoo. Why should Gus have to do all the work? I love it. Music to my ears.
Right.
Let's see. Caller in Norway, did I hear you? I thought he spoke up simultaneously. 4:12 a.m. Norway time.
Yes, thank you. Some commentary on what I've heard. I found Professor Horne's counter-racism, it was quite sophisticated. You could hear some, a few of his answers. I remember one earlier, he said he didn't exactly want to get into the details of how we should respond to, like, violence and so on. And I'll definitely see if I can. One thing I realized today was that I've read a lot in the past. I thought I read a lot in the past 2 days, but I'm really happy that I was able to get in this question about his own scholarship and how he works, because that was quite inspiring for me. And in the future, I think I will write my questions down, so I won't have to come, you know, to create them as I'm speaking. Because I was a big fanboy, a huge fan, and of course, I will go to sleep early and try to wake up at 2:00 in the morning to catch this program, because it's one of the best in the world for meeting like minds about counter racism. Thank you.
Well, I am a big fan of sleep. I cannot say if Gus T lived in Norway or any of our other locations, South Korea, I'm not sure Gus T would be up at 4:03 in the morning to come on here and chat it up with retired firefighter and you all about racism. I'm not going to tell you that would be happening. Like, we would have to figure out something else and maybe do it in the middle of the daytime. Global Sunday Talk. That is the reason that program is in the middle of the day, so that we can kind of find a balance so that nobody has to be up at any, you know, wacky hours for these discussions. But, whew, man, I say that with Stacy as well. I think she originated the timestamp for folks who call in, making sure that we are keeping track of who is keeping really late hours because they are serious about replacing white supremacy with justice. Other folks have commentary?
Yes, to the call in Norway, is the area a very mountainous region? I guess he does.
Yeah, okay. He's up there. I'm here. I just
reached
my phone and it takes a while to unmute it.
Okay, I was just asking, is Norway, does it have a very mountainous area, you know, where you can see mountains, a lot of them?
Yes, sir. It's okay. Very mountainous. Denmark is quite flat. Norway has a lot of mountains. I'm from Jamaica, and before I came, I thought, they wouldn't have much in the way of trees as well. It would just be evergreens, but they've got a wide range of fauna here. What's really distinctive about Norway is its coastline and its fjords. So it's got a lot of on its coastline, or even in the regular part of the country, you can see where the sea has like broken into the country, and there's lots of water. Water spaces that reach far into the country, it would seem. Lots of mountains. Beautiful country. Very quiet people, but they still practice racism here.
Okay. Because the Nazis under Hitler actually, I don't know the right word to say, they kind of like, for the short period of time, colonized Norway during World War II, is that correct?
Yes, sir. And there's a movie called The Heroes of Telemark. because that's where the regions that were fighting the Nazis destroyed a facility that the Nazis were using for producing heavy water that could be used in a
Oh, yes.
Yeah. That's not far from where I am. That's not far.
Wow.
That's actually in Telemark, and that's one of the regions that my university is located in.
Okay, that's right. That is the area where they use the heavy water because they have their plans to make an atomic device. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for the question.
What's the name of the film that you recommended, sir?
I think it's called The Heroes of Telemark, but that might be the Norwegian. Let me just look it up real quick.
Oh, okay. While he's searching, did any other folks have any observations, thoughts they wanted to make sure they shared? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. I've been hearing this term gaslighting, and I think I've been hearing it recently since, like, the state of protest over a George Floyd killing. And I'm not sure I understand what it means. And,
I don't either. I heard it too.
What is the term? Say it again. Backbite? Is that the term?
It's called gaslighting.
Gaslighting. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Yeah, I do know what that means, but okay.
Yeah, so I really don't understand what it means. And someone said that to me, that I was gaslighting them because I told them my definition of racism and white supremacy. They said I was gaslighting them and I was making them think something that wasn't there. I was a bit confused. So I was wondering, Gus, if you had like some kind of understanding of what that term means.
It has been used on this program generally in during programs on neutralizing workplace racism, where that's been a term people have used to describe how white people mistreat them in the workplace. That when they go to report that they're being abused or that racism is being practiced against them, folks have reported that they will gaslight you. That's nonsense. You're just making up stuff and finding different ways of saying that you are lying. When you're talking about racism, that's generally, or being mistreated, that's generally what it is. That is a little bit irregular for me to hear black people being accused of gaslighting. That is irregular. That is a that's the only reason I know what the term means, is because of neutralizing workplace racism. It's not a term that I used, and I hadn't even heard it until neutralizing workplace racism, and then people started using it frequently enough. It was like, oh, okay, I got it, gas. And then I would see it in other places where people were using it in the same way. Just generally, it means you are often deceptive. I think that's implied by the term, that you are deceptively, knowingly trying to tell someone that, oh, you're reporting something that's false, you're doing something that's false, you're trying to convince me of something that's false. It's generally a deceptive act where you know I'm trying to confuse this person. I'm trying to, you know, make this person think that they are just paranoid, that they're just making things up, whatever they're reporting is false, where I know, nope, it's true. Whatever they're saying is absolutely true. They are being mistreated, but I'm going to do everything in my power to convince them that that is not the case, and see if I can convince them. That's my understanding of the term and the general context that's been used. And again, that is a huge deviation. If you giving your definition of racism, if that is cause for a white person to accuse you of gaslighting them, like, wow, that is not standard. That is not in line with how I've heard the term used.
And I must say, it was not a white person who said that to me. It was a non-white female who said that. But we were on the program with a white male. He was the host.
Mm-hmm.
And we were on the program. And, you know, I'm speaking about my definition about racism and white supremacy. And, you know, she says, her first question was, oh, do you hate white people? And, you know, I'm saying at no point did I use that word, hate, in my definition. And she's like, oh, but what we're describing is hate. And because So she said, what I'm known as, because even though I'm not using the word, that's what I'm saying. And that is, I'm gaslighting. So I'm the place that happened. I was very confused about that interaction with that non-white female. And interestingly enough, that white male, basically I was talking to him about racism and white supremacy. And, what I think to anything white supremacy, we would need a revolutionizing of mind by people who are classified as white and not white. And when I called in, he was like, oh, you know, he doesn't want to debate me and get his hands dirty. He says, and I'm like, I didn't even call to debate. I called to have a conversation with you. And I said, you know what, since you think it's going to be a debate, I'm going to come off this call. And the non-white lady called in, and he's like, oh, you know, here's a fellow female, not a person of color. Let you guys talk. And I find that white person does it a lot, where he picks non-white people against each other to debate about racism and white supremacy. But yeah, that was what my interaction was. I was very curious about the term met, because I didn't understand. But thank you,
Fascinating. The dictionary definition for gaslight
real quick?
Is yes, sir. Just the dictionary definition for gaslight: manipulate someone by psychological means into questioning their own sanity. The sentence that they give for using gaslight in the first episode, Karen Valentine is being gaslighted by her husband. And then they say that this is the storyline for a movie in which a man manipulates his wife into believing that she is going crazy, when I guess she's not. So I guess if it's just manipulating you to think that you are crazy, going insane, if there is no system of white supremacy racism, and you were trying to convince her by giving your definition, I guess that could maybe be gaslighting, maybe. But if there is a system of white supremacy and you just give your definition, even if she disagrees in it, that doesn't seem to fit the definition. And now that you give the whole context of it, I mean, white people are extraordinary at that sort of thing. Racists are getting non-white people to squabble with each other about racism. That's why I said a huge component right now is the anti-blackness, not squabbling with other black people. VGQ, heard that mentioned already. VGQ, victims guaranteed, qualified, whatever position you take as a victim is cool in the gang. But white people are great with that. They'll just step back and let us squabble. I don't know if this was someone, a victim who's like a fan of this white person who hosts the program or whatever it is, but victim, that was the word I started with, this victim could just have white people's script, like literally. Those could have been the talking points, or it could just be that she has heard the standard retorts and how white people try to confuse us and what have you, and just say, oh yeah, I'll just gaslighting, that's how they normally diffuse and deflect when non-white people present truth about this problem, and I'll just use the concept even though it doesn't really make sense according to what you just said, because there for sure is a system of racism. So you are not sending anyone crazy by saying, oh yeah, white people, they're practicing racism globally, as a system globally. That is not gaslighting. That is just a matter of figuring out what should be done to solve that here problem. The person who spoke up, yes, sir, we can hear you.
Yes, I think you were being gaslit, actually, by the non-white woman. You gave a definition, and she said, no, that's not true. And ultimately, I think you're being gaslit by the white moderator of that program. He knew where you're going to, he probably guessed that you're going to talk about racism. He wanted it to be not seen. So he manipulated a situation where another non-white person would gaslight you for him. So he's the ultimate gaslighter in that situation. That's my opposition. So he was a telemarketing name of the movie. It's starred by Kurt Douglas.
Douglas, the great Kirk Douglas, Hollywood fame. White people are extraordinary at that, especially when a non-white person reveals truth about racism, like, ooh, get out of this conversation immediately. Not supposed. Matter of fact, do we have another? Yes, you two non-white people, talk it out. Hopefully you all will come to blows, and I can come in to clean up the mess. They are excellent at that sort of conduct. That's why so much of it is keep the attention on the folks causing the problem. Racist man, racist woman, racist child. Any other folks' observations? Gaslighting, what we heard from Dr. Horne?
Yes, sir, Gus. Just a report to give to you and others. The white person, quote-unquote protester that was in the golf cart that was supposed to be a retired firefighter. Well, I was informed a couple of days ago that he actually worked on the same fire department that I worked on. I don't recall him at all, but I think I'm trying to remember Chief's name now that came on your program. Yeah, Chief Phillips said on a Facebook account, on Mr. Clark's Facebook account, that he did work with him at a particular station. Just let you know that, and he's probably getting publicity now that he doesn't want, you know, right now. But nevertheless, just a tidbit of information that I received a couple of days ago. But I don't recall him at all. But he is typical of the type of coworkers that I've had through that 28 years that I worked on that job. He is atypical. The Dade County Fire Department immediately did what they call "quote unquote" distance themselves from him with this email address. That they said that they don't support anything that he says, and he was on his own and whatever. But in all the reality, that the Dade County Fire Department was and still is full of people like that white male. I just wanted to address that to everybody and yourself. Thank you. Mm.
Retired firefighter ratting out his former colleagues. Oh, well, no brotherhood in the fire department. Does not surprise me.
White power.
There it is. There it is. With the number of incidents that we've had about, you know, fire officials, white fire officials, practicing racism and N-word here and urine there and all the rest of it, I'm not surprised at all. Probably lots more where he came from. He's and she's others with similar thought process. I did want to get in. You heard me mention White Dog at the beginning, and you got a robust second from Dr. Horne, who said, make sure you've seen the film. I already have. It's great. In fact, I recommended the film first. I knew about the movie, and then I found out about the book. But he mentioned Paul Winfield, who's a black male. His character is even more important now. That I've read more detail. I actually had this book in my hand. That's one thing I can say. Like, wow, reading is more important than watching television. Sometimes you read books when it is time for you to read them. Like, you might have that book, but it's not time for you to read it. Like, other things are supposed to happen. Maybe you need other information. You need other life events to really appreciate and absorb that information. But generally speaking, it is good to read books when you are ready. Like, you don't give someone who is 4 years old the ISIS papers, right? You give books at the time when you are ready. Woo! White Dog. And I can think of that with a lot of books that had in my hand, did not read that. Invisible Man, my favorite book. I had it in my hand for years. It took a long time before I finally read it. White Dog, book I had in my hand for a long time. I'd seen the film, thought it was great, got the book, just, you know, was not ready to read it. I assumed it was pretty close to the movie. The movie, to refresh folks, came out in the 1980s, 1984, if my memory is correct, 82 or 84. The NAACP protested this movie. They were so quote-unquote successful that studios didn't release the film in theaters, and NBC was going to air it on TV and refused. It basically, the movie is about a white woman, single, well, take it back, a white woman, she finds this dog, it's a white German Shepherd, she takes it home, puts out, you know, or notice rather that she found this dog, collect it. She doesn't find out until a little bit later, as does the audience, that this white German Shepherd hates black people and has been trained to attack them on sight. So he kills one black person and then maims another black person before they found out, like, oh, okay, this is a racist dog. So as opposed to killing the dog, they take him to a trainer to see if he can be rehabilitated, made not racist. And it just goes from there. In the movie, Paul Winfield plays the black trainer who is going to fix this racist dog. And it just goes from there. Now, the book, as is usual, is way more interesting. One, what made this is, I think, going to be the next book for the book club, no question. How can we read anything else? Is based on a true story. I didn't know that. The author, Romain Gary, he's a white man from a different country, I think Russia or some Eastern European country. He comes to the States. He finds this dog. So we're kind of similar to the movie somewhat. He finds this white German Shepherd. They take him in. He's great. And then they realize, like, oh, wow, this dog hates black people. He's dumping and trying to attack black people. So they take him to a trainer to see if they can cure him and make him not racist. They take him to a black doctor who, in the book, the doctor's name, Mr. Keys. Welsing moment. So they take him to this doctor, black male. They talk about racism. This is in the movie. He does go to a black doctor and all, but the change begins here in the book, which is allegedly based on true events from Romain Gary's life, where this guy was here. I think he married Jean Seberg, this white woman, so-called activist, who was hanging out with the Panthers and such. He's hanging out with Marlon Brando, who helped get guns for the Panthers during the 60s and 70s. He's hanging out with these people and criticizing them in the book, mind you, which is all left out of the movie. So it continues. He gives this white dog to this black black trainer. The black trainer is a Muslim. We talked about the Nation of Islam. The black trainer is a Muslim. He trains the dog to attack white people. Dog goes back to Romain Gary. He bites Romain Gary. I'm cracking up laughing, like, because I didn't know it. Like, I've known that this book was published like 50 years ago, okay, before I was born. Movie came out in the 80s. I saw the movie. I didn't know about any of this until basically the cow started. I think this is the first movie that I watched when I got my laptop. So I'm looking at it and I'm cracking up laughing, like, are you serious? Like, one, this is like loosely based on true events. And then two, all of this is in the book that they left out of the movie. Like the black Muslim trainer, and blah, blah, his name is Mr. Keys. He trains the dog to attack white people. That is the next book for the book club. If we needed another reminder after having Dr. Horne on with all of his extraordinary literary accomplishments, White Dog. In fact, I'm not even sure if the English word, because this fella I just said, he was some European country. I think the original version was published in French, and it was a bestseller. They translated it to English, but I think they might have changed the ending. So have to double check. I would do all in my power to make sure we could get the version where the dog is trained by the Muslim and bites the white people and all of that, like, to get it, you know, the way it originally came out. Yeah, that's the next book for the book club, I think, hands down. And as Dr. Horne said, you should watch White Dog. Wow, it is a phenomenal metaphor for white supremacy, racism, the system. What if it's titled White Dog? What does it mean to be white? It's titled White Dog. What does it mean to be white? It's titled White Dog. What does the dog do? He kills black people. That, and he has a great, I posted the, there's an article where he kind of describes this in shorter form, and then the book goes into obviously more detail. But in the article, they talk about once they find out, like, oh, wow, this dog kills black people. Oh, and then the kicker, it's a German Shepherd. They say in the book, it is an Alabama police dog. For added context, now, even though they find this dog in California, but it's an Alabama police dog that's been trained to kill black people. They say in the book, when they find this out, so they take him to be trained, they put him in a kennel cage at the trainer. And so Romain Gary, this white man, he walks by, and the dog loves white people. Like, he's never agreed. He said it was like watching The Incredible Hulk, or, you know, somebody that you've known, like, morph into a totally different person. And then as soon as the black person would leave, he would switch back. Just be total love and kickles and come kiss on me and just loves everybody and licks all on the children. It's just, you know, the greatest little plaything in the world. Super well behaved, shakes hands, super well behaved. Long as it's only white people. Anyway, but this should be the next book for the book club. The movie, as I said, is phenomenal, even though it is a little bit different. The article, that was what I meant to finish. The article, it says that they got the dog in the kennel, and the white man would go to see the dog like he's in jail or something. He would go for visitation hours, and he said the dog would look so sad, like, what did I do? I always attack the Negroes. That's what I do. What did I do wrong? Don't you love me? It's just like, wow, that is... Woo! That is the system of racism, white supremacy. And added bonus, if you get the Blu-ray or DVD version of Training Day, Denzel Washington was mentioned. We are right and exact as usual. If you get the DVD with the bonus features, there is a deleted scene where Denzel Washington talks about this dog that hates black people. And he goes into detail. He says that this happened. He says this was what he saw when he first started training. He saw a black guy beating a dog, which is the exact story they tell in White Dog, but it's in the deleted scenes for Training Day. He says he saw a black guy beating a dog, and he asked the guy who was training them, like, what is that? Like, we should go stop him. Like, that's animal abuse. He says, no, just leave him alone. He says, what do you mean he's beating the dog? Let's go. He says, no, he's training the dog to hate niggers. And Alonzo, that's Denzel's character, Alonzo says, what? And he said he just looked and he didn't even know what to do. And that started his career in law enforcement. You see how it goes in training. But yeah, that is mentioned. That's not the first or the fifth time that I've heard about the white dog, the racist trained dog that hates black people. Shout to Dave Chappelle. Any other thoughts folks want to get? If you've read White Dog or seen the movie, any other thoughts folks want to get in? Reading more important than watching television.
I got something real quick.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much. In his earlier years, Kevin Hart made a joke about a racist dolphin that seems to makes a callback to animals hating black people. And Romaine Gary, the author's wife, was a French actress named Seberg. And she was played by Kristen Stewart in a film last year. And in that film, there's a bit of focus about how Seberg is very interested in the Black Panthers and her white boyfriend gets jealous. Thank you.
Fascinating. That is in the book. That element is left out of the film, but that element is in the book, White Dog, which is another reason why I wanted to read this. Him criticizing her involvement with the Black Panthers, and Marlon Brando as well, who played the Godfather in Don Corleone in the Godfather series. But yeah, that is all in the book, White Dog. Another reason. Next book on the book club. Henry in Chicago.
Yes, hopefully you or somebody can direct us to a download of the book. I just went on Amazon. They're trying to sell it for $75. I refuse to pay that. I'll try to go to the library and see if they have it, but yes, I refuse to pay $75 for that book. So,
Black Self-Respect. Good decision. I had it at the lot. I mean, it was a bestseller. Like, this shit, I mean, it is older, right? So this is not hot off the presses, but I mean, it was a bestseller. They made it into a movie. It's should be available at a lot of libraries. Now, if they're open or not, that will be another problem. If the libraries are open, you know, it'd be really easy for me to get a PDF version so that we could share and make sure everybody has a copy, but we will have to see. Yeah, we'll have to see if we can make it easy. But yes, I don't have a copy in hand myself, so I'm going to have to make sure I get a copy that is way under $75. And then once I do, we'll see about making it easy so that everybody can, who wants a hard copy so that they can follow along, can do so. But yeah, I had this book in my hand. They had it, that was why I wasn't even worried about it. I was like, oh, they got it at the library. Like, no special order. It's, you know, just right there. Bestseller. Should be. They had all these big Life magazine articles and everything about it. I would even think, like, unless this book is also really constructive with regards to getting an accurate understanding of racism, there should be, like, a lot of used copies. If people have used bookstores and that type of thing, it was a bestseller. You know, when they have bestsellers, there tend to be lots of copies around that you can get for a nickel, a dollar, $3. Use the bookstores. Check, see if they got Romaine Gary. White Dog, I'll see if I can help out as well. Other folks, any additional comments they want to make sure they get in? Grand. Had watermelon today. It's been a very, very awful summer. But I had watermelon and cherries today, so try to keep things in perspective. They can't be too bad if you get watermelon and cherries in the same day. Speaking of bad, I am not sure, but Facebook looked like they removed the cows page, but I hadn't posted anything to even be scrutinized. Like, this is not Gus went on the Facebook page talking about kill white people or cracker this or nigger that even. I think the last thing I posted was a news report that the mayor of Kansas City, Missouri, Quentin Lucas, was threatened with a lynching. Someone told him that he was going to be hanging from a tree for ordering that citizens of Kansas City wear masks because of the coronavirus situation. But that's, I think, the last thing that I posted. I just went there today, and they were saying the page might have been removed. That was another source of stress. I was trying to share the event for the program and couldn't even find it. Hopefully, that situation will be resolved if we have folks who use Facebook. I know people have been abandoning Facebook left and right. That would be another reason to leave. But if you would like, you can send a message to Mark Zuckerberg. We did not post any criminal activity, no hate speech, no violence. Nothing to encourage the boogaloo or protests or any of the like. As I said, I think the last thing we posted was about an elected U.S. official being threatened. That should not be grounds for removal of a page. But again, we are in a system of white supremacy, so maybe it is. Anywho, we will continue. We're on Twitter. At Until Justice, and my Facebook page, I guess if it's there, the problem is white people. Let's see. Yeah, if you have any other questions, feel free. Drop an email. Let us know. We'll be here. Not tomorrow. I was confused, I think, for a bit. Tomorrow is Wednesday. So not tomorrow, but Thursday. We will be here for the book club, continuing with Einstein on race and racism. Fred Jerome, Roger Taylor, I guess however you look at it, we're about halfway through. It's not a big book at all, so I'm trying to see if we can pressure Mel into reading White Dog 2, since I just read the abomination before this book, and don't feel like I should have to resume any narrating anytime soon, even for a great book. So if anybody has great compliments or other ways to positively encourage Mel the Great to do more narration, feel free, but she should be hanging in with us for Thursday for Einstein on Race and Racism, Section 3. With that, we will call it a broadcast. Hope folks are doing their best to navigate a very traumatic, challenging, confusing year. Take it serious with the virus. One of my so-called friends just reported having some symptoms and not being well, and obviously they were distraught. Take it seriously. I would encourage being in the house, wear your mask, wash your hands. Take it serious. You do not want to mess around and have to go. Fireworks, I just heard them. It's still daylight. It's not even 8 p.m. And the fire, we talked about this, this past weekend. The battle simulation, gun simulations have been prolific, and they just had fireworks going off here. But that notwithstanding, take things seriously. If you don't have to be out in big groups and anything, avoid all of that. It is way too confusing to be reckless with moving about in space these days. That in addition to armed white people. Lots of dangers in 2020. Everyone content for the broadcast? Got in everything they needed to share?
Yes, I noticed the thing about Facebook a couple of hours ago. That's why it took me a while to find the Free Conscience Hall information. And I suspect you might be right. It could have to do with that posting about the elected official. But Facebook, I've seen other cases the past couple of weeks where you could be informing about something that is wrong, and then their senses take it that you are actually doing the thing that is wrong. So it can be some confusion, either uncaused or probably just deliberate on Facebook's part, and I hope the page comes back. But if not, I'll be following on Twitter. Thank you very much for a great show.
Much obliged. She can make new pages, but I mean... Yeah, I'd heard about that as well. Certainly other folks where it was the same type of thing. People reporting about racism had their content taken down and saying that they violated rules, even if they were just posting a news report, which was the last thing we posted was a news report, not, you know, incitement to violence, name calling, any of the such. Again, news report of an elected official being threatened for encouraging people to take the health pandemic seriously. Sure, I get that in as well, because there's been a whole lot of that. Black public health officials threatened, just saying, hey, I think the Rona is something we should take serious. Maybe wear a mask or try to stay at home. And they end up being threatened. Hope you die. Hope you are killed. Global system of white supremacy, racism. Anywho, sobriety would be best. We have got so many problems throughout the known universe. Man, we are going to need all of our brain computer working and then some to get this here problem permanently resolved. We do not need narcotics from whites. Poison. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled when we go out and about. I have said for about 3 months now, let's kind of ease up on the being out and about. Dangerous times. They were protesting down in Dr. Horne's, Texas today. The signs said, Bar Lives Matter. Doesn't get any better than tacky. I saw the signs. I'm pretty sure there were some firearms there because it's Texas. So I mean, but I'm pretty sure they had firearms. You do not want to be out and about being reckless, gallivanting, not paying attention. With everything that's happening right now, you especially want to avoid confrontations with whites or anybody else, really. I would assume this person could be armed. It could be a group. You just have no idea what's happening right now. If anything looks suspicious, dangerous, anything looks out of the ordinary, you get that feeling that we talked about with the gift of fear. Halt. I would call things off, go back home, get to a safe spot, and then reassess. It's just no reason to take a risk with so many dangerous things happening all over the world right now. If you don't have to be out and about, stay at your residence. That's it. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy, no name calling other black people. VGQ, this is a time to invoke victims guaranteed qualified. We do not have to agree, especially if white people are trying to play Don King matchmaker and see if I can get my two favorite niggers to square off and joust each other over their views on VGQ really make sure we are not getting into, you know, contests and going back and forth and disputes with other victims about their response or lack thereof in the midst of all of this. No name calling. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves and remind us to engage in lots of self-care, get our rest, eat well, take time to nourish ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Yeah. I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.